Hello, my name is Marcus. I'm the compiler of a collection of therapy quotes entitled 1001 Windmills of the Mind. This song you're hearing in the background is the song we featured in the last video. And this video is sort of a continuation of the last video. So I thought I would use this song as sort of a bridge. So this is sort of part two, or a continuation of TQ2191. So in this video, we'll do TQ2192, and that'll sort of round it up. And at the end there, we'll do TQ93. The song is called Rock and Roll Lullaby, sung by the Nylons. She was just 16, and she was all alone when he first came to be. They grew up together. His mama, child, and me, and him. So whenever he would cry, she would calm his fears and dry his tears with a rock and roll lullaby. She'd sing. Touching lyrics, so later on he recalls that in childhood that his mother would sing this lullaby to him. He doesn't recall the lyrics. There's no reason to try, because he knew that lots of love came through when she sang the lullaby. So it's a good song about the mother is there to soothe the baby. Babies come out of the womb too early. Mothers offer what's called a maternal holding environment, where the baby is soothed by the mother. The brain is very malleable in the beginning. The baby metaphorically relies on the mother's brain, so to speak. When the mother soothes the baby, because of the fusion, the baby's wiring is set up in the way, in response to the way the mother wired the baby. In other words, the mother soothed the baby, the wiring is laid down, and then the baby can soothe himself. So in yesterday's video, this was in reference to one of our topics in 1001, Windmills of the Mind, a subject called projective identification. Baby's distressed, mother understands, is attuned, understands the signal, and can respond and soothe that, the baby's distress. The baby is soothed by it. So a sort of a cycle takes place, a loop takes place. Now, if that loop doesn't take place, later on, the person is going to try to do that with others. Because when there's trauma and it's stuck, they're going to replay it and reenact it to see if they can change the past using a new, using the present as a new edition of the past. Now, it can't be done because the past is the past. So in the present, they're going to coax others to feel what they can't feel, similar to how the baby was feeling something and the mother was able to feel it. So in the present, they want others to feel what they don't know that they're feeling, because the baby didn't know he was feeling it. So in the present, they don't know they're feeling something, so they want to coax others to feel what they can't feel. Yeah? But the cycle can't complete. Even if the person can get the other person to feel what they can't feel, that's it. No neural networking can take place. No fusion can take place so that the neural networking can take place. So even if the other person is taunted or coerced or induced to feel something that the projector can't feel, that's the limit of it. Now he's disappointed he didn't get the neural networking that he needed from the nursery. So the boulder rolls down the hill. He didn't master the trauma. So he's going to try again. Because it's meant for him to be able to have the memory of being loved so that he can see himself, hear himself, know himself, think for himself. The mother mirrors the child, means she feels the child, sees, hears the child. He can do those things for himself. When there's trauma, the child's feelings get put into the unconscious bag. So in the present, he wants to get mother's response. So he'll coax others to feel what he's feeling, but he doesn't know that he's feeling it, but he wants to coax others to feel it. So actually, he's trying to communicate it. So in the nursery, the baby communicated to his mother that he or she was feeling distressed. The mother received the signal and responded. The child felt soothed. Okay, now in the present, the person wants to communicate like the baby, like they did when they were a baby. They want to try again. They want to communicate what they're feeling. Get the other to feel it, just like how the mother picked up the signal, meaning she sort of felt it. Now, from the baby's point of view, it's fusion. They're one there. So if he feels it, he thinks the mother feels it. And the mother sort of does pick it up and senses it, and to a degree feels it herself, for her to be attuned like that. So if that doesn't take place, if the mother gaslights the child, so later on, the person, they want to coax others to feel what they're feeling, to communicate what they're feeling. Now let's say the other person is somehow induced or coerced or somehow manages to end up feeling what the projector's feeling. And then what? What's he going to do? What's the receiver going to do? He'll manage himself. The projector says, oh, okay, that's cool. He can manage his feelings, but the projector didn't manage his feelings. But what he might do is when he coaxes others to feel what he can't feel, that preserves his infantile megalomania. All babies think they're little gods, so when they coax others to feel what they can't feel, that preserves his infantile megalomania, the grandiosities, infantile. Babies create an image of themselves called the glorified self, or the idealized self, or the ego ideal, chasing this phantom glory image of themselves. The search for glory, meaning preserving the infantile megalomania period. All babies think they're little gods, everything's about them, everything serves them. They don't have to care about others, or worry about others, or have empathy for others, because they're engaged in what's called part object relating. The placenta serves the baby. The breast mother serves the baby, and they're stuck, but they're sort of stuck in that mode. But while they're stuck in that mode, they think they're little gods and everything's serving them. So that's called the primary narcissism. So if he's frozen there with the trauma, again, trauma, he's frozen. He's going to replay, reenact that scene that led to him being frozen to see if he can become unfrozen. So he's trying to undo what happened. But that can't happen after the age of 5. But he's going to replay and repeat symbolically the past and the present in an attempt to, in his unconscious fantasy, to change the past, because the past, the baby lives in a state of timelessness. So they're going to do it again and again because there's no time, so they're doing it again and again. But our conscious mind can recognize that if we are engaged in some kind of reenactment of the past and the present, distorting the present, misusing the present, you know, seeing the rejecting mother onto the person in the present, or seeing your shame self onto the person in the present, identifying with the aggressor, shaming the other to communicate that your mother shamed you, somehow reenacting the situation in the nursery in the present. That's meant for the person to recognize that there's trauma. Repetition compulsion is a mirror that there's trauma. Russell says they're synonymous. Okay. So back to protective identification. In the babyhood time, for him to grow and develop, he needs to be soothed, meaning he's safe. But if he's distressed and the mother ignores it, the child thinks, oh, mother's not safe. Now, the baby's in an immense double bind. He can only turn to his mother, but she's the source of pain and shame. But he can only turn to her. What does he do? He freezes his feelings and it goes into the bag, the unconscious. Or in the non-reporting brain, somewhere in the implicit memory system of the brain, or the metaphor is the bag, the unconscious. It goes in there somewhere, in the brain somewhere. In metaphor, we say it's the bag that we drag behind us. And we put our feelings in the bag. And it's frozen. It looks like the... So in the bag, we got the image of the woolly mammoth. Apparently in Siberia, there's a more or less fully preserved woolly mammoth frozen in a block of ice. And he's been like that for the past 30,000 years. I can't think of a better image to describe trauma. How our emotions are frozen. So that poor woolly mammoth frozen in the block of ice. Okay, that's in the meaning us frozen. That's in the bag, our feelings, you know. So we're afraid to feel. So that's the trauma, that we lost the safety. We have to sacrifice our feelings. It's as if the baby's saying to the mother, "Hey, mother, I have these needs." Mother says, "I don't get it." "Oh, you mean, do my needs bother you? You seem uncomfortable with my needs." "Well, I don't know what you want. I don't know what you need." "Okay, mother, don't worry." Because the baby wants to attach to her, have this connection with her. "Okay, don't worry, mother. I'll sacrifice my needs." That goes into the bag. "But you know what, mother? My doing this makes me feel kind of angry. I want to tell you I'm angry." Mother says, "Oh, I can't handle that." "Oh, you're also uncomfortable with my feelings? My needs and my feelings, both of them, mother? You're really uncomfortable with all of that? Oh my God, mother. Well, fine. I'll sacrifice my feelings." The feelings goes into the bag. So the baby's going to accommodate his mother, adjust to his mother, adapt to his mother, placate his mother, try to fix her, save her, do what she wants. The baby will do anything, everything imaginable that he can in an effort to bond to her. The baby's first priority is to bond to his mother. All of his life force is in that effort to have the attachment to the mother. Now he's looking for a safe attachment. So this is the baby's first environment. Humans adapt to their environments. The baby's first environment is that rejecting mother. How does he adapt to that rejecting mother? He adapts by putting his golden ball in the bag, his feelings, and his ability to know what he needs, likes, wants, interests, that goes into the bag, meaning deep in the brain somewhere, but he's not aware of it. It's called the non-reporting brain. So this is all an attempt to try to move towards having a connection with the mother. Now, it does lead to some kind of connection with the mother, but it's at a huge cost. This is called an insecure attachment style. This is a kind of developmental, relational, interpersonal trauma. And because of the constant micromisattunements by the mother, over time it's called a strain trauma, or a stress trauma, or an emotional trauma. So the title of one self-help book is called, "Do I Have to Give Up Me to Be Loved by You?" That's the actual title of a self-help book. That's what the baby basically does. He'll do. Now, actually, today we have a quote in reference to this. Oh, hold on a second. Let me get this back up. So let's do that quote now of what we're just referring to here. This thing keeps locking out on me. Okay, the primary caregiver's agenda takes precedence over the needs of the child, requiring that the child relinquish self-initiative and spontaneity and instead resonate with the parents' needs and expectations. That is, the child is forced to attune to the mother and follow her lead to stay connected. The result is an attachment experience that is not secure enough, that it's too conditional to support the emergence and flowering of the child's real self. Right. That's pretty good. So that's a pretty good description of it right there by the Roberts. Yeah, so the last video, which I think was pretty good, by the Roberts, and this is also by the Roberts, they were students of Masterson, one of our mentors, James F. Masterson, and the Roberts team here, a couple, they were his students, and they wrote a book called Another Chance to Be Real, a very good book sort of summarizing Masterson's work. And he himself summarized other people's work. So it's a very good book, I think, to read. Again, the primary caregiver's agenda takes precedence over the needs of the child, requiring that the child relinquish self-initiative and spontaneity. So that's his true self. That's his real self, right? He's going to relinquish his truth, his feelings and needs, in order to resonate with what the parent wants. The child is compelled to do this and follow her lead in order to stay connected to her. He's got to have the connection with her. So, like the book title says, he'll give himself up to be loved by her. And the result of this is called attachment failure. The baby doesn't have a proper attachment. That's called attachment failure. The greatest hurt of all, mother failed me. So in this example here, the mother failed. Now we're not blaming, we're not meaning to say it in a way that we're blaming her. So we have a whole thread around why a mother is going to be misattuned to the baby's needs. If she thinks she's supposed to use the bottle in the schedule and make the baby cry at night and puts honey on the rubber nipple, these kinds of shaming activities. And if the baby's removed from the mother at birth for too long, that'll do it. They'll be disconnected. That's called a betrayal trauma. So the continuity of this trust and the safety was broken, right? So if there's an insecure attachment style, that's not going to support the emergence and flowering of the child's true real self. See, if his true self gets put in there and he's frozen, he doesn't go through the developmental path. The child is meant to go through a sort of a developmental phase in the first 3 years. First, he needs the extended womb. Humans come out too early. Human babies come out of the womb too early. We don't understand why fully, but they're completely helpless. They can't walk, they can't talk, they can't do it, right? They're very dependent, helpless. Someone said even little chickens, when they hatch out, they can at least peck around, run around. They're already more, you know. Humans they come out too early for whatever reason. So they need an extended womb. For the first 4 to 5 months, they need an environment that's womb-like. They need a womb-like environment for the first 4 to 5 months. The range seems to be between 3 and even 7 months in some cases. On average, 4 to 5 months. That means the baby feels warm and safe and secure. His needs get automatically met, no conditions, just like they were met in the womb. In the extended womb, that attitude continues. So the mother has to be attuned and be able to read the baby's signals. The baby feeds according to his wishes, not according to some magazine schedule written by some company that's selling powdered stuff or something. Nothing like that. You follow the baby's lead, not the greed of some. So, see, the guy who wants to sell the product is saying, look, mother in the mind, I'm showing you up. I'm getting other people to be, I'm getting other mothers to treat their children in a misattuned way because I want to communicate that you misattuned me and my, when I was nursing with you. You see, mother, so I'm talking about the advertiser or the company or the shareholder or whatever it is, whoever's doing this, right? So that's another topic. It's called negative magic gesture. So a negative magic gesture is treating others the way you were treated to communicate how you were treated and how you didn't like it. So let's say a guy was misattuned. He grows up, opens up a company that sells the powdered stuff. He finds others who are in a similar situation who are involved in the advertising business. So together, they put a big campaign saying, mothers, use the powdered stuff. Don't listen to your baby's signals. Ignore your baby. Use the schedule. So those people are basically saying to their mothers in the mind, look, mothers in the mind, I'm getting other mothers to be misattuned because I'm trying to show you how you are misattuned to me. That kind of thing. So there are a lot of reasons why a mother might be misattuned to the babies. We're not blaming her, we're trying to understand why. Of course a mother would like to be attuned and understand the baby. We're trying to understand why, what's happened, what goes wrong, why do many mothers have a problem understanding the baby's signals and needs, and why is she shaming the baby? Is she shaming the baby to communicate that her mother shamed her? Is she shaming the baby because she's so eager to convert the baby into a surrogate mother for her, to use the baby to meet her emotional needs, and in the process the baby is shamed by that because their needs are getting ignored? So we're trying to understand this area here. So we have a thread on there to cost the style of mothering. Mothers are there to meet the needs of the baby, not the other way around. If it is the other way around, so we're calling that the Jocasta style of mothering. Okay, so life forces object seeking. The baby's got a bond. We all know that the baby wouldn't make it if he didn't bond to his mother. So he's got a bond. He's got to attach. Even if it's a shaming mother, rejecting mother. Even if, right? The baby would rather bond to a painful mother than have no mother. So how is he going to adapt? How is he going to deal with this if it's so much pain? He's got to do a lot of tricks of the mind to do it, to pull it off. So he squelches his feelings, he squelches knowledge of his needs and wishes, that gets repressed. He denies that his mother's rejecting and creates a hallucination that she's loving. It's called a splitting mechanism. He might be loyal to the image that he creates of her. Now he's got to be loyal to the mother. So dysfunction is loyalty to the mother. Why is he being loyal? Why is he being dysfunctional? To be loyal. Why is he being so loyal? Because the more unavailable the mother is, the more the baby needs her. So he clings to her in this loyalty because he needs her love to know himself. So he's waiting for it. So he's in a catch-22. He's not getting it. He needs it to leave her. He's not getting it, so he's waiting. And he can't leave it unless he gets it, but he's not getting it. So he's waiting for it, but he's in a catch-22. You see? So... Now, during this time, the baby creates a template, a psychic template called a schema or a traumatic script or some kind of working model, some kind of internal mapping of some kind, some kind of schematic in his neural networking in the non-reporting brain, which basically says, in terms of his memories, if we were to translate his memories into words, it basically says, dysfunction equals pleasing the mother. That's for the attachment. Dysfunction equals the attachment. And he's stuck there. That's a trauma. Now, when he's traumatized like that, he's going to reenact the disappointment with the mother with others. So he'll coax others to play that role. Or he'll flip it. He'll shame others and identify with the aggressor to communicate his childhood that way. So there's two ways it generally works. Either he directly recreates the disappointment with the mother with others by coaxing others to disappoint them, or he'll just disappoint others to communicate that his mother disappointed him. And it's this reenactment is repetition compulsion. He's constantly trying to see what happened. So he's replaying, reenacting the past and the present for him to see that he's creating this mirror to know that there's trauma. He's meant to witness for himself that there is trauma. Repetition compulsion means trauma. So if he observes he's doing repetition compulsion, then he knows there's trauma. Then he can become a psychological detective. He can become an existential detective and try, work towards separating from the mother. Now, he can only separate, the baby originally can only separate from the mother if he or she is loved by her. If that doesn't take place, how does he do it by himself? Very difficult. That's called the second journey of midlife. We've got to do it ourselves. Now we're older, we have more knowledge, now we can think, now we can, we have more resources, that kind of thing. So man, that's called man's main task, is to give psychological birth to himself. If that took place, if that trauma took place, he's got to reparent himself through the mourning process. So he's got to recognize the truth that he didn't get the love that he thought he got. There's a huge sadness in that, because the person will go, oh my God, you mean I as a baby didn't get the maternal holding environment? I wasn't seen and mirrored? I wasn't seen, heard, and felt so that I can see, hear, and feel myself? You mean I didn't feel safe to go through, to differentiate? You mean the mother used me to comfort her? You mean the mother didn't know how to offer a secure attachment style because she never got one herself? You got to kind of look in this area. It's called the truth will upset you free. That's the grief work process. So the truth upsets. That's the feelings are coming in. That's the grief. So when you're upset, now your feelings are coming in. Now you're starting to differentiate. When you face the truth of the mother, you're going to start to differentiate by the feelings around that. Then now you're giving psychological birth to yourself. So the idea is to differentiate from the mother. If the person's still fused with the mother in their template, in their unconscious, the concept of the self and the concept of the mother, it's still blurred like that. Remember in the first, in the womb, it's just all the baby. Everything around him is just blurred with him. In the first 4 to 5 months, that's still there, right? It's called the stage of symbiosis, undifferentiation. Baby doesn't understand that he's separate from his mother, me, not me, or where I end, the mother begins. It's just too confused like that, right? Sometimes called the stage of fusion. The unico mystica, mother-infant dual unity. It's a powerful feeling. It is a blissful, oceanic, blissful, Garden of Eden, paradisical feeling. The Wakanda, the mana, it's strong as well. It's a happy kind of feeling. We sort of get a taste of that in marriage during the honeymoon phase. We get some glimpses of that. We partially re-trigger that up in the honeymoon phase. Right? People feel, the two of us, we can do anything. They feel happy together, strong together. So that was the feeling the baby had in the beginning. So in the memory system, in the implicit memory system, if that didn't take place, if the child didn't get the love to leave the mother and he's still stuck with the mother, the fusion is still within. So if in the template, the image of the self and the image of the other, or some kind of concept or representation of the self and the concept or representation of the mother, or some kind of understanding of the other and the self, if it's all blurred like that, okay, that's going to lead to pathological melancholia, complicated grief, pathological mourning, aggravated grief, the derailment of the grief process, prolonged grief, etc. Because later on, if there is any kind of loss, they can't admit it. Because to admit it, if they were to try to admit it, they have to go back in the template. Other and them are one. So at midlife, if there's a loss, they're not going to admit it. Because in order to admit it, you got to look at the template. The template says other and self are blurred there. So to admit a loss at midlife, emotionally, it would feel like admitting the loss of yourself. You can't do it. That's complicated grief, right? Now, related to this is that the golden ball is in the bag as well. He doesn't even have his feelings to grieve. We need our feelings to grieve. It's natural to feel sad when there's a loss. It's natural to cry. It's a natural human response to feel sad and cry when there's a loss. But joy, the characters of joy and sadness in the Disney movie Inside Out, they're in the unconscious world. They're in the bag. So in that Disney movie Inside Out, we saw the characters' joy and sadness in the bag, in this other world, fantastical world. And we saw at the console that all that was remaining was the amygdala, this hyper-reactive survival fight-flight mechanism, fear, anger mainly, and impulsive and irritable and quick to anger, this kind of amygdala phenomenon. Right? But the human feelings are in the bag. The human feelings of joy are in there. Joy's in there, right? and all the feelings related to joy, interest and curiosity and things. Now the empathy this comes from the sadness part. Now the sadness was in the bag. The ability to mourn, the ability to cry, the ability to make reparation, the ability to feel, make repairs when there's a mistake. Joy, sadness is in there. So joy and sadness was repressed. So all that the person had at the console was fear and anger, the amygdala. So now at the end of the movie, the success was joy and sadness came back in. That's the image of being reunited with our golden ball. So the golden ball went down, the golden ball came back. Right? So we want to be reunited with ourselves. Right? In the Odyssey, Odysseus was reunited with himself. Ithaca and Penelope represented himself. Ithaca is the soul castle within. The feelings for him was Penelope, right? Again, myths and fairy tales are metaphors for psychology. They're like dreams. They describe a psychological story for a person. Myths and fairy tales are true on the inside, not on the outside. That's a major thread, so I won't redo it here. So back to projective identification. It all starts with the baby feeling distressed. Mother's there. The other, mother. Now remember, in the word mother, put a little dash between the M and the O. Okay. So, baby's distressed, the mother, later the other, but let's just start with the mother. The mother gets it and responds, the baby soothed, the neuro networking wiring takes place. Now he can soothe himself, he can do for himself what his mother did for him, because he has a carbon copy of the brain circuitry between them that allowed that to happen. He now has it complete within himself, so he can soothe himself, and he can be calm himself, right? So that soothes the amygdala, of course. The amygdala doesn't need to be overreacted by this. But if that doesn't take place, then the amygdala is overreacted, because joy and sadness go into the bag. So later on, because of the amygdala is so reactive, and because trauma, when there's trauma, there's this innate drive to get a better outcome for the past, to not have that trauma from the point of view of the timelessness of the unconscious. The puppet, the bag in there is running the show. So in the person, Bergner calls it the puppet master. This, if we were to imagine all of our disowned traits in this bag, if there's too much there, it has a lot of motivation, a lot of desire. We don't want too much in the unconscious. We want to make it conscious. We want to convert unconscious memory to conscious memory. If there's too much in the unconscious memory, that means there's too much trauma. The more trauma there is, the more there's this drive to heal the trauma. Okay? So it's going to distort the present to replay the past in the fantasy that it can change the past. Okay? It can't be done, so they're going to do it again and again. But the idea is to be aware of the positive intention of repetition compulsion, which is to make us aware that there's trauma. So one phenomenon, one way, one mirror that's being created is that when a person coaxes others, the other, the mother, to feel what they can't feel, that's a mirror to know that the mother didn't complete the cycle with them when they were a baby. Nobody in the present is the breast mother, nor can anybody invent a time machine to take the two back to the nursery, morph back to the respective roles needed, so that the person as a baby can have those neural networking, hop back in the time machine, come back into the present, and feel that he doesn't need to coax others to feel what he can't feel, because he knows what he feels. He has his feelings. If he doesn't know what he feels, he wants others to feel it for him. Now there's a secondary gain by this activity, because when he gets others to feel what he can't feel, he feels a little uncanny delight by this. Oh, you're feeling sad or scared or angry? Gee, and he created it, and he sees it outward, that he doesn't have to see it within. But he created it, so that preserves his infantile megalomania, so he feels important. He doesn't deal with the anxiety of accepting his truth, which is too painful for him to do. So he gets a kind of a benefit by doing this. So he's going to do it again and again. It's going to be reinforced. So we talked a little bit about secondary gain recently. But the cycle can never complete with anybody post age 5. The cycle can never complete. The idea is to mourn. The idea is to be, to talk about the truth, and then realize the truth. Let yourself be responded by the truth. Now this can only be done in the presence of a caring witness. We can only do so much with reading the quotes in the books. Ultimately, we need a caring witness. That's called the yin and the yang of healing. So the knowledge and the free association, the models, the theories, the quotations, being aware, searching, being our own detective and searching for the scripts and searching for the schemas, learning about defense mechanisms, that's sort of the yang side of it all. But we need the presence of a caring witness. Grief is healed when it's witnessed by a caring other. So the loving presence or the caring, safe presence, that's the yin of healing. We need the yin, so we need the yin and the yang. 1001 Windmills of the Mind can only work towards making an effort to make a contribution towards the yang side of healing by sharing what I believe to be some of the best quotes from the psychoanalytic perspective, the second language, this philosophical medicine. So this is my second outing here at this little table here. So it fits in quite well with yesterday's part one. This is sort of part two. So yesterday I talked about how we did many of our videos on the rooftop of that. I don't know if it's showing up there. Sometimes this camera doesn't line up with where you're pointing it at. We played the song Up on the Roof and by the Nylons yesterday as well. You know, Up on the Roof. But it's a Sunday afternoon here, so I think I'm able to use this venue again here. Oh, locked out again. Hold on a sec. So let's get this back here. Okay, we're back here. So projective identification, meaning coaxing others to feel, demonstrate what you're not aware of yourself. Right? And there's many ways to do it. So for example, one example we have here is the guy that, the bossy one. Let's see, let's do that here. So we have one example of it here. In tomorrow's video, we recently gave an example, and let's do, it'll be in the next video, but we can do it here. Hold on a sec, where is it? Where's that one about the bossy? Here it is. So here's an example of projective identification. Projective identification occurs when clients, quote, project or attribute or assign, just believe, certain thoughts, ideas, or feelings onto the therapist, and the therapist actually behaves toward the client congruent with the behaviors that have been projected onto him or her. Now, the therapist feels a certain kind of pull by this. Okay, for example, a client may see the therapist as bossy and therefore acts passive. The therapist then actually acts bossy in response to the passive client. Through the process of projective identification, clients may recreate interactions that occurred with significant others in their lives. Okay, that's a pretty clear example, right? So if the mother was too impinging and engulfing and demanding, that's in the memory, and that was a traumatic. Now they're with their friend or the therapist, and they do some slight little thing. It can trigger it up. The template, the relational unit within can be triggered up. Bossy parent, passive compliant child. In the last video, we talked about relational units, psychic templates. So when we operate from these templates, we refer to them. Now, these are traumatic templates. We're just gonna replay them until we're aware of their existence so that we can change them. So if the traumatic template, the memory system says, bossy mother, wounded, compliant child. Now, the therapist has a little bit of an authority quality to him. The parent was a sort of an authority. So they may just automatically click, it just triggered up. Now they're going to reenact that. Now they're going to see the bossy parent onto the benign therapist. And now they have the thought, oh, they're very bossy. They're talking about the mother. They're emotionally responding from the memory that's forgotten. Now, in the child, they were passive. So he's going to assign the bossy mother image to the therapist and say, and just think that, oh, they're very bossy, they're very demanding. And now the template says when he was a child, he was very passive. Now his goal is to recreate the dynamic that he had originally with the therapist. So he's going to be the passive child. So he'll be uncooperative, passive, whatever, indifferent, kind of, yeah, okay. He's going to reenact that. Now eventually, if a person does that in real life, the other person, whoever they are, might get a little frustrated and start to be a little bossy. Come on now, we're here to work, and we'll talk to you, right? Aha, I knew it. So he recreated it. So when there's trauma, we use projective identification in order to recreate the memory of the childhood to create a mirror to see what's within, okay? Here's a very good summary of the whole psychoanalytic, here's a very good summary of psychoanalysis. This one here, that'll be up in the next video. The client's interpersonal patterns with the therapist and others serve as a clue or a pathway or a mirror to the client's intrapsychic organization, okay? His psychic templates, his inner object relations model within his intrapsychic organization. It is through the analysis of the intrapsychic, the inner world, the inner psychic, the unconscious memory system, or the implicit memory system, the models within, the object relations units within, okay, it is through the analysis of the inward material that lasting interpersonal change comes about. So if we want to change and make our interpersonal relationships more healthy, we got to heal these templates. Now these templates are a record or a template of the trauma, and we're just reenacting it again and again until we become aware of their existence. So we're going to be dysfunctional, misperceive, misuse the present to fit that script. And then reenact that script. Our goal is to reenact that script. Number one, with the delusion that we can somehow magically get a better script because it's still operating from the time of timelessness. But we know there's time, but the unconscious doesn't know there's time. The inner child doesn't understand time. Maybe that woolly mammoth doesn't have a concept of time as well. Huh? Yeah, I don't think animals have a conscious concept of time, really, do they? So our inner wounded inner child is sort of in that pre-early stage, right? In terms of the ability to understand time. So they're in the timeless state. So once we mourn and face this, things sort of, the healing takes place, feeling and the healing, so the grieving is the healing. Then the split images of the mother come together. Oh, okay, then we differentiate. So we want to resolve the splitting mechanism to ultimately create an inner working model of the other as whole, not split as goddess and demon, right? Just a whole other person separated from a differentiated self concept that's whole. Right? So that's I'm okay, you're okay. Mutuality, it's called whole object relations. This is what normally takes place in normal, natural, good enough, healthy development, at least to differentiation. That means you're going to see others as persons in their own right. You'll see yourself as a person in your own right. Right? You see each other's humanity, you each other's three-dimensional, they have feelings, personal history, wishes, needs. You see all that and you understand it, and because you have that for yourself, you understand that for yourself. So naturally empathy and understanding comes in this process of the mutual side of things. Now when there's trauma early on, before differentiation, that's called part object relating. The baby's just relating to the parts to be fed. The placenta and the breast, it just still feed, and he's stuck there. So he's still in that mode of wanting to receive. So of course the greed comes from that. The greed is the repetition compulsion of being frozen during that earliest stage. They're just replaying, not getting love properly. So they're going to be greedy to see if something symbolic, a mother, can satiate them, but it can't be done past the age of three. The boulder rolls down the hill. They still feel pain. They're going to do it again and again until they realize that greed is a mirror. Greed is a pathway. Greed is a clue or a mirror to the client's intrapsychic organization. The intrapsychic organization in greed is that the self and other are still one there. Yeah. Somebody said when there isn't some kind of attachment, people are greedy. Do we have that one here today? Let's see. Okay, it's coming up in a future video. We have a video, we have a quote in a, coming up, maybe in the next video, that basically said when there isn't connection. Oh no, it is in this video, hold on. We've got a lot of great quotes to present. There's a lot of great quotes out there. Yeah, here it is here, this is in today's video. This is part of 2393. When human connection fails, pleasure seeking becomes a solution to the fundamental need of the human being for attachment. Okay, so if the baby doesn't get a secure attachment style, he's going to be greedy, seeking the stimulation of the pursuit, that's the dopamine and the catch, that's the serotonin, that's the pleasure seeking. It's not the interest pleasure seeking, it's sort of this greedy kind of pleasure seeking. This fleeting moment of dopamine for the chase for something, serotonin from the catch. But that can't zoom the person back to the nursery and have that interaction take place. So the baby's at the breast, he cries out to his mother, that's the dopamine. The mother meets the baby's needs, that's the serotonin. Dopamine for the chase, hey mother, where are you? That's the dopamine. And then the mother responds, she gives the response, that's the reward. The baby feels soothed. That's the serotonin, because he's safe now. When he gets the reward, he feels safe, and then there's serotonin. Okay, dopamine for the chase, serotonin from the catch. So in the babyhood time, the cycle can complete. If that cycle doesn't take place in babyhood time, later on, it's going to be greed. Dopamine for the chase, grab something that's some material, means unconscious association with mother, it's a material, it's matter, material mother, right? It's hard to convey that idea. Marion Woodman tried, she also couldn't quite do it. She struggled with that as well. Why material unconsciously reminds somebody from the unconscious point of view of mother. She said the best she can come up with, well, they share the same Latin root word of mater, meaning matter, like matter leads to material and money and mother, and all comes from the root. Well, a mother is the root. The root word is mother, matter. They're all linked, they're all blurred there in Latin or something. So the person's going to look for matter, material stuff, right? That's the chase. Now, when they buy the trinket or the shiny thing, whatever it is, so they got something. Now they feel a little, that getting of that something resembles how the baby would have gotten the response from the mother. Okay. So in the greed, they get the thing, they get a little serotonin, but it doesn't change the wiring in the brain. It doesn't, the cycle can't complete. Okay, so they're going to be greedy again and again, to know that greed is a mirror for trauma, that projective identification didn't complete. So so greed is a mirror that the self and the object are still fused. The more unavailable the mother was, the more the baby merges with her. So they're fused there, because he's waiting for her love. So he's going to be greedy to get it, but after age 5, whatever he gets that's symbolic of her is not her. Some synthetic matter thing is not the warmth of the real mother back in the nursery. You can't travel back in a time machine. Put it this way, the trillionaire or whatever, with all his stuff and his castles and 10 cars, or whatever, he can't put all that stuff in a time machine. He can't take his portfolio or whatever, put it in a time machine, zoom back to the nursery, somehow magically see his portfolio morph into a good breast mother and feed him or something. It's not going to work. It's ridiculous. I don't even know how to describe it. Some kind of, it would need to be, I think if the sci-fi story created something like that, there might be some kind of unconscious appeal, because unconsciously we wish it could happen. We wish that greed could give us the love that we didn't get. Marion Woodman's example is that the baby needs sweetness with the mother. If the baby doesn't get his sweetness, tenderness, kindness, sweetness with the mother, later on, he's chasing sweets, literally sweets, the sugar stuff. It's just a coincidence that they share the same sort of... It's an interesting coincidence that the words are the same. The baby's looking for mother's sweetness. He doesn't get it. Later, he's addicted to sweets. Now that's a symbol. So the candy thing it's an accident that it shares the same word. The candy thing is just a sugar that tricks the brain to think that the person's safe, because long ago when a mammal gets lots of sugar, then the animal, the mammal feels safe, so the brain sends them serotonin. So the sugared stuff tricks the brain to send the person serotonin. So they're getting the serotonin, but for the moment. But the sugared stuff is not gonna, it's not gonna zoom the person with the sugar, with the candy bar back to the nursery and convert the candy bar into his mother and then be soothed and secured by the mother. It's not gonna happen. The candy bar in the present just tricks the brain to send them serotonin. That's all it does. It metabolizes very quickly. It just goes through. It doesn't change the past. No candy bar can change the person's past. Let's put it that way. No candy bar can change a person's past. Greed cannot change a person's past. We're trying to identify the past. Yeah. See it. Witness it. Now the truth will upset us free, because when we do see it and witness it, we're going to be sad about it, because that's a sad state of affairs. That poor woolly mammoth, if stuck in the frozen block, frozen in that block of ice, if somehow he could be conscious that he's been stuck in that state for the past 30,000 years, if he could somehow have a little consciousness about what's been going on with him for the past 30,000 years, he might be so sad at that, he would start crying, and maybe the ice, he would be free from the ice block. I think that's a very good summary of it all right there. If that woolly mammoth somehow could be conscious of his state, he'd be very sad and angry, and he'd maybe roar or something, and the ice would be broken, and he'd run free. He'd be free, emotionally free. That's synonymous with the grief process for humans, I think, yeah, as I understand it by reading all this stuff. Again, I'm not a shrink. I'm not a therapist. I'm not a professor. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a midwife. I'm not a doula. That was a joke from last time. I'm not a doula. So I'm the compiler of the quotes. Somebody said the best way to learn something is to teach it. So it seems like I'm sort of trying to teach it by giving these kind of anxious lectures, I guess. Special lectures, or I'm not sure what I call it. So yeah. So why don't we just finish up with what's coming up tomorrow? Because tomorrow there's going to be a little bit about grief. So feelings associated with the grief work process. Now remember, a person doesn't engage in the grief work process if all of his feelings are buried. But ideally, what's meant to happen is feelings related to acceptance of loss, for example, a divorce or something, can include, well, in the beginning, there's numbness, disbelief, shock, denial. And then maybe finally, okay, now you're reminiscing, bargaining, searching. Now you're starting to get angry and guilty. Now, oh my God, now it's sinking in more deeply. Disorganization and despair, loneliness, helplessness, hopelessness, fear, anxiety, right? Abandonment, depression. Now, if you can hang on there, right? Finally, you're going to start to accept the loss, and finally, you're going to be able to move forward, move on after you accept the loss, that kind of thing. Now, while you're grieving, you don't want somebody to say to you, "Oh, just get over it. Oh, don't cry. Oh, just give us a smile now." These remarks can make the person who was hurt feel devalued, angry, and misunderstood. The listener's unconscious fear of pain may lead them to disconnect emotionally and fill the silence with some protective platitude. Huh? And then you say to the person, why are you patting me on the back and saying get over it, get over it? Well, rationalization, and he'll make some excuse. Rationalization, the invention of reasons for ideas or actions when the real motive is not recognized constantly. So let's say someone did go through a divorce and they're feeling sad. They're talking to their friend. You know, I think I'm kind of feeling sad about this. And it says, oh, no, get over it. Good for you. Yeah, you'll get through this. Get over it. Well, I'm not... I guess it depends on his tone or his... But if he says things like, oh, don't you dare cry on me. Don't you dare. Or, you know, like if he says stuff like that, come on, give it... Just smile now. I want to see you smile. Don't... The grieving person might say, why are you trying to smother my feelings? Why are you trying to spiritually bypass my feelings? So he'll use rationalization. Well, it's not helpful, is it? Is it helpful? It's done. You can't change it, right? You can't change the past. So he'll make up some rationalization. He'll make up some idea or reason that sounds kind of reasonable to mask the true motive. The true motive for the guy saying, get over it, smile now, is that he can't feel it himself. He's being triggered. He doesn't want to face that feeling. That's why he's patting the guy. He's patting him on the back with some protective platitudes. He's protecting himself with these platitudes. That kind of thing. In the next, we've done a lot of good work on transference, so that's coming up tomorrow. Transference. Clients repeat many of the same behaviors with their therapists or with others that they did with their parents. So we want to interpret this and how these patterns have led to many of their interpersonal difficulties. In unraveling the details of the transference, it is essential to think in terms of the total situation of the childhood, transferred from the past into the present. We'll do one from Robert Bly, he's sort of a guest mentor in 1001 Windmills of the Mind, and a couple of others. Yeah, when there's, this is a good one for transference. Clients often find themselves experiencing the therapist as they experienced important people in childhood and may make unrealistic demands for love and attention. So if you have these great, immense, unrealistic demands for perfect mirroring, perfect responsiveness, perfect attention, mind reading, that's transference, right? Because the mother metaphorically could read the baby's mind. Because of the fusion and the attunement, the baby understood the baby's signals. So from the baby's point of view, it's as if the mother could read the baby's mind. Now later on, a person might expect that. I don't want to ask for what I need. You're supposed to know before I ask and meet it and satisfy it before I even know it myself. Okay, that's unrealistic. That's an example of transference. So we'll talk more about this bit here and others in the next video here. So maybe we'll start to move with today's quotes here. So let's go back to the Roberts here. Again, they did a great job summarizing Masterson's work. In the course of normal development, so what's normal development? Normal development, the baby, there's no prenatal distress syndrome. So the baby isn't shock traumatized or overstimulated while in the womb. The baby has a welcoming womb. There's a thing called an unwelcoming womb or a rejecting womb. If the mother goes to the heavy metal concert while pregnant, the baby can be very distressed by the loud noises. And the theory is that the mother's cortisol can enter into the baby through the placenta and the cord. It can enter into the baby. And the baby has an enlarged amygdala already at birth. So he's already lost his joy and sadness potential. And he's born already in the fight-flight mode already, you know. So, So there's no prenatal distress syndrome. There shouldn't be any birth shock trauma. If the baby's removed for too long, that can be a trauma. So we have some quotes about why it's important to hand the baby directly to the mother right away. You leave the cord, again, I'm not a doctor, that's my disclaimer, but barring emergencies and special cases and all that, the baby's handed directly to the mother. The smells are there, the skin-to-skin contact. The room is darkened with some candles. The room is warm. You want to preserve the continuity of the womb life in the extended womb. You want an extension of the womb, in the womb. So it's a smooth delivery. The baby just goes right on the mother's front. The baby might start to latch and nurse right away. It can happen instantly, they said. Or there's a delay. That's okay. A little while. So the cord stays. The placenta stays. The cord apparently is still pulsating with oxygen and nutrients and things. Okay, so what? It doesn't look pleasant. Now the placenta can come out a little later on, maybe a day later, a few hours later, or something. Whatever it is, the placenta can come out on its own or gently. The placenta can be put in a bowl. It can sit on the bed beside the mother. You can put a lid over it, but allow the cord there. Let the child have that continuity, because the cord and the placenta belong to the child. They're part of his. They're like his first. They're his lifeline. They're his lifeline to the world. Like that's his mother in a way, right? Like that's his connection to his mother. You know, that's very important for the child. So you want to. So what if it's messy for a day or two? The cord and the placenta. They'll fall off on their own accord, huh? Or at least wait 2 days or something, whatever, until they're dry. So anyways, that's called a lotus birth, a natural birth. So you don't want like shock there. But the key point here is as well, that at the moment of birth, the mother produces lots of hormones. So when the baby comes out, the baby can smell the mother and, oh, there's mother, yes, I get it. And all the oxytocins, they're gonna bond and latch, and the baby's safe and secure. And he has an innate expectation for the breast, his mother and her breast. He has an innate expectation for it. He's already searching for it. They said, one quote said that when the baby was placed on the mother's front, the baby actually kind of moved around a little bit and found the nipple and started to latch. So he was already searching for it from the beginning. So there's this innate sort of expectation for it. Now, if this takes place and the baby latches, all of those hormones facilitate the baby's symbiotic merging with the mother. And that facilitates and helps the mother to kick in for her ability to be attuned and understand the baby's signals. You see? So it helps the baby and the mother. The latching helps the mother to be able to be attuned and be able to be so-called entrained, like a train on the right track with the baby, in sync with the baby. Now, if the baby's removed for too long, Klaus and Kennel say that the hormones that the mother produced are then starting to dissipate. Now already the baby's shock traumatized, where's mother? Now if the baby's in another room and a stranger gives the bottle, oh my God, what's this? No mother, no nipple, no breast, and some nurse comes along, what is all this? While that's happening, the baby's disturbed by this. He's already traumatized at the birth by this. Now finally the baby's returned to the mother. The mother says, what's this? Because she's grieving. All of that oxytocin, and now all of that oxytocin is dissipating. So she's kind of mourning. She's kind of sad already at the loss. The baby comes in, and some mothers say, no, get that baby out of here. The baby's interfering with my loss feelings. She can't provide the love because she's in the bodily somatic process of mourning the loss. So the mother says, get out, to the baby. The baby says, I'm being rejected here. Who's the stranger? What is all this? So there's already a birth trauma. So that's not normal development. That's attachment failure. So again, barring special emergencies and exceptions, the baby is directly handed to the mother on the front, skin to skin, and the baby nurses according to his schedule and needs, and the mother makes herself comfortable. One suggestion that's been made is that mothers just stay in bed for four to five months. Sleeps, catches up on her reading, the baby basically just sleeps and nurses for the first 4 months 4 to 5 months. And the mother will know when the baby starts to hatch out of that egg, this second womb-like environment. There's a second hatching. The mother will know when the baby can start to hatch. When the baby starts to hatch, okay, now that's huge, because if the baby doesn't get that maternal holding egg environment, there's the bully pattern, there's the Iago pattern, the cynicism, the criminotic pattern, a lot of these difficult patterns, personality patterns can spring forth. So the bully pattern, for example, it wants to force, that's a trauma. They didn't get the egg environment, the symbiosis. So they want to force the lackey to be one with them and get them to serve them, like the mother was supposed to serve them. It doesn't work. But his behavior to do that, to be aggressive, to force the lackey to respond to him, his slogan is respect. Is respect, not love. I don't want love, I want respect. Like response, he just wants like a response. But the response is back to the baby, got the response from the mother. But whatever response the lackey can offer, it's not going to translate to zooming back to the nursery to getting the love that he needed. So it doesn't work. So the boulder rolls down the hill. So he's going to do it again and again. And that's a mirror. That's a mirror for that person to consider that they didn't get the maternal holding environment. Or one author said that they were prematurely ejected out of the egg. Maybe they started to get it and then they were prematurely, it was ruptured. And it didn't get back in, and didn't, mother couldn't heal it, those kinds of things. Now the Iago one is a very disturbed version of the bully pattern, because that's like a closeted, withdrawn version of the bully pattern. Now their goal is like Iago, and the character Iago, they're just filled with envy. They don't even bother looking for a lackey. They just find other extroverted versions of them. So on the Enneagram, the unhealthy 8 is an expression of the unhealthy 5. They find people with the bully pattern to be their extension for them, to do what they wish they could do. They can't even be the 8, so they become the unhealthy 5. So they trick 8s to do things for them. In other words, the Iago pattern spreads rumors and does sneaky little things and covert little things, whatever, to get others against themselves. All he has is envy, because everything out there he can't get. He doesn't believe it. Goodness triggers the memory of not getting the goodness that he needed. That's painful. So he wants to see the goodness damaged, so he's not triggered of not getting the goodness. So envy is hatred of the good. So the Iago has complete hatred of the good. And he was just, so he was a good, he was one example of a character in literature that was just filled with envy, and he caused all this trouble with others, and he felt schadenfreude, and he preserves his infantile megalomania, that kind of thing. So it's very important for babies to get that egg, to get that first 4 to 5 months. So again with the suggestion, mothers stay in bed for the first 4 to 5 months. The baby feeds what he wants or she wants to feed. The mother doesn't say, no baby, you don't feed now. The schedule doesn't say that. Really, in the womb, in the uterus, was there some kind of schedule? No, the baby fed according to his natural cycle or rhythm, whatever it is, right? Can you imagine a baby in the womb and someone says, oh, wait a minute, we got to follow some schedule. We got to prevent the natural thing that's taking place. So that's really... So we have a theory around why babies were removed from the mothers starting from 10,000 years ago. Why were babies removed, right? Why did they shock traumatize? Why did they betray the babies 10,000 years ago? So we have a whole thread around that. I won't do it here, but it's been done in other videos. That's a huge topic there, that one there, right? Well, if you see me a little anxious and speaking, it's because this coffee is unusually strong. I think I gotta lighten up on this coffee. Maybe the good thing is I can cram in more material if I'm a little anxious. Maybe that's one good thing about it. I am eager to get this material across, you know. Let's see the rest of this scenery here. I'm sort of in a run-down, soon-to-be-renovated small meeting room. So at the moment, it's sort of in that midway phase. So until they kick me out, I hope they don't kick me out, because this is like the last spot I've found. Oh my God, all of my other venues are no longer usable. The pool I can't use. I did about 6 videos near a pool. It was very nice. Most of them were done. Many of them were done in that hotel, that slim one there, the gray. Is it showing up? Okay. The gray and black one there. Some were done on the rooftop, some were done on the ground floor. And many of them were done in a hotel near that hotel. So all of my videos for the past 3 months were done in over these 3 hotels. 2 videos were done in an outdoor coffee shop. So I would say the past 3 months have been, there's been some good material. A lot of great quotes. I don't know about my delivery, but the quotes, some great quotes. And I'm still feeling badly about the 17 videos that got lost from this summer. From May to August, I really started to get on a roll. I was getting views, 20, 30, 40 views per video. I was in the double digits. And I thought, okay, yeah, my delivery's better. It's reflected in getting some views. And then mysteriously, those 17 videos, over 50 hours of commentary, my best work, suddenly got deleted. I was very sad about that. So for the past 3 months now, I've been trying to get back to where I was. And those videos in the summer, they were done on the shoreline. We had Canada geese and loons and herons and lots of mosquitoes. The occasional blue jay and the fox, once with the fox. We did some good. Now, luckily, the good news is that the quotes are preserved. We have the quotes there. So the quotes are in the collection, both on YouTube and in the actual collection. But my commentary is sort of missing. But and all of the songs we played and the self-help exercises we did, that's all missing. So I'm slowly trying to get some of that, repair some of that. But I feel like recently we're starting to get back into some good material here. Okay, so normal development, as I understand it, is the baby, it enters into that egg. If it doesn't, the bully pattern, the Iago pattern, the lower functioning BPD, some of these symbiotic character disorders, and the criminotic pattern comes from there. Because the criminotic pattern is, he didn't get any kind of glimpse of his mother. So there's this oral rage, they call it. Now, Bergler says that may be a part of why the crime takes place, but he theorizes that it's the lack of the connection to the mother that's the issue. The mother didn't respond to the baby's rage at not getting his needs met. So later on, he does something illegal or whatever, and the response he gets, that's a fantasy of his mother responding. At least if he can get the mother to respond, that's some connection to the mother. So crime is an attempt to get some kind of connection to the mother. That was his theory. Now, the other quote we had was, it's just the oral greed thing and the infantile megalomania, not caring about others. So they're kind of blurred there a bit. So that's a very undeveloped thread. Again, we have 50 threads. We started recently 2 new threads, art and the crime. So that crime one only has 2 quotes so far, by Bergler and I forgot his name, the other one. That was just very recently. Okay, so normal development. The child enters into the egg. If he does enter into the egg and he can start to hatch out, or if he does enter into the egg, he has the connection. the chances are they might not have those disturbed personality patterns like the envy guy and the ego one and the bully pattern and all that. Now at 5 months roughly, the baby's meant to hatch out. But he hatches out on the condition that the fusion with the mother is good enough, it's positive. So the bully pattern, they didn't really get the fusion or the connection, they didn't enter into it, so they're more belligerent or they're more envious because of that. Now the baby who does enter into it, he does have the safety with the mother because eventually they're going to become just like her, because if it's not warm enough for him to know himself. So let's say the baby does enter into the egg and he's meant to hatch out at the age of 4 to 5 months, but he can't because it isn't a safe symbiosis. It isn't a good warm symbiosis. That has to be like a loving symbiosis for the child to hatch out. If it's sort of this painful adhesive, one person calls it adhesive identification with the aggressor. One person calls it the tar pit of a negative symbiosis. The tar pit of a negative symbiosis, if he's still sort of stuck like that, now that's the narcissistic pattern. He's constantly being shamed by the mother. He's going to identify with the aggressor and then shame others to communicate that his mother shamed him, is shaming him. So in the template, the mother's shaming him. So he just replays that, reenacts that outwardly by doing to others what his mother did to him based on the template that he created of his mother. Now, when he creates a template of his mother, it's not a reality of his mother. It's an image of his mother that he makes up. He makes up an image of the mother. This image that he creates is mainly his feelings. So for more on that, refer to the earlier part, the last video. In many of the videos, I've discussed why a baby is able to create an image of his mother as a devouring monster that wants to eat him. So the narcissism pattern is the fusion is still going on with him. He didn't differentiate. Now, he may not be so belligerent and rude as the bully pattern and the Iago one, because he has the basic safety of being the mother, because he is the mother now. He identifies with the aggressor. So he feels very important, arrogant, narcissistic, entitled. Right? So all babies think they're little gods. In the narcissistic pattern, likewise. Now, they merge with the mother. They become the mother. Now, the mother was seen as a bigger god. So they feel very inflated. They feel, so shrink yourself. Shrink, you gotta shrink your inflation. So they feel very inflated by having a fusion of thinking that they're so important like the mother was over the baby. And simultaneously that preserves the baby's infantile megalomania, the grandiosity. So the baby thinks he's a little god. By identifying with the aggressor, he gets to keep on thinking that he's a little god by the identification with the aggressor. Now, the identification with the aggressor offers that secondary gain of him preserving his infantile megalomania, glorified self, idealized self, ego ideal, etc. Now, why does he identify with the aggressor? Because he's being loyal to her. But how does he be loyal to her if he's so pained by her? How does he be loyal to her? He figures out a trick. It's called adhesive identification or identification with the aggressor. He's going to become a caricature of her. So that's the compromise he makes. Yeah? That's how he deals with the pain of being shamed by his mother. He's going to become a caricature of her. So he's going to shame others to communicate that his mother shamed him. That's how he's being loyal to her. The script says dysfunction equals protecting the mother. Dysfunction equals being loyal to the mother. He's still being loyal to the mother because he needs his mother's love to leave her. But he's not getting it. It's too painful. So he in the meantime, he's going to act like her, stay loyal to her, and express his anger at her in a sideways way. So remember, the baby can't express his feelings towards the mother? So when the baby identifies with the aggressor, he's going to shame others to communicate that his mother shamed him. That's a sideways way where he protects his mother, at the same time communicates that his mother shamed him, because he hopes maybe that the world will see what his mother did to him. If he does to others what his mother did to him, he thinks maybe others will get what his mother did to him. So he's trying to communicate or show up, Bergner says, show up to mother. He's trying to show up to mother by doing to others what his mother did to him. He's going to become a caricature of her. He's right. That's a huge maladaption. That's a huge desperate mirror. So if a person is engaged in negative magic gesture, shaming others through your cynicism and dark humor, put down humor, shaming humor, because you're trying to communicate that that's what your mother did to you. She shamed you and humiliated you. The mother objectified the baby. The baby said, don't you care? Mother said, I don't care. The mother gaslit the baby. That person shames others. Don't you care what you're doing? He says, well, wait a minute. I'm imitating my mother. My mother didn't care. And you're asking me if I care? So their slogan is they don't care. One of their slogans is they don't care. Looking up for number one, don't care. These kinds of things. You know. So the narcissistic pattern and the bully pattern, Iago pattern, the criminotic pattern, they're all taking refuge in the grandiosity, impotent megalomania. Yeah. The main emotions are hate, greed, envy, or grenvy, spite, vindictiveness. They can't take feedback because feedback means the other knows something they don't know, they're not, right? So they'll be enraged by that. And then the vindictiveness is they'll want to put the other down to preserve their one up. Now, a lot of this has the related benefit that they don't mourn. They don't look at how they didn't get the love to differentiate from the mother because they have complicated grief, pathological nostalgia, yeah, and pathological mourning. So the melancholia or the pathological mourning, the complicated grief where they can't grieve, is because, again, like we said before, to admit a loss, it means you feel like you're losing yourself. But if the truth is, the person should have feelings towards the loss of the other. Those are going to be directed toward the other within, other mother within, but the other is them, so now it's directed towards themselves. So that's a lot of pain to be angry at yourself, to be scared at the loss of yourself. That's a very painful situation, this complicated grief, this pathological nostalgia. So they're going to mask it over with the manic defense. So those personality patterns are also, they're all manic defenses. Prejudice comes from there. The bully pattern, the narcissistic pattern, these are all manic defenses. Bergner calls it pseudo-aggression because you're not directing your true life force feelings, anger, towards the mother. You're directing it sideways because you're still protecting the mother because they are the mother. They can't criticize their mother because they are them. If you criticize the mother, they feel criticized. So the narcissistic pattern is a very... people often say they feel like they're on eggshells around them. Got to be careful what they say, what you say, because they easily think that if you're giving them any kind of information or feedback, and if they can't be cynical towards you about or stonic or shame you by what you say, and there's something truthful in what you say in the feedback, they'll be enraged. That's called narcissistic injury, narcissistic rage, to preserve their one-up status. That's their identity. So they have a false self-identity, and they think that's their true identity. So they're very invested because that's all they have, is the false self. They can't rely on the true self because the true self is so shamed, and they see it outward. Now, the tragic irony is they're shaming themselves outwardly, and others are filling in for that for them. So the mother shamed them. They were shamed. That's the hungry, enraged, empty part self, the despised self, the hated self, whatever. They see others and say they're no good. They hate them, that kind of thing. That's to communicate. So they're actually replaying what happened to them, just reenacting it by shaming others. Now, this is a mirror to see that the mother shamed them, or that they felt hated by the mother. So a lot of mirrors are being created. So this, let's go back to that last quote. So the last quote in the next video is this one. One by Waska here. The client's interpersonal patterns with the therapist and others serve as a clue or a mirror to the client's intrapsychic organization. Okay? So the intrapsychic organization is they didn't differentiate. They don't have I'm okay, you're okay. They don't have empathy and gratitude for others. Love and gratitude haven't entered the psychological picture. So that's a mirror. If the person doesn't have love, gratitude, empathy, tenderness, affection, caring, sincerity, any of the, a lot of the virtues, they don't have that kind of thing. If they're just operating out of the amygdala, the fight and the flight, right? That's a mirror to know that the intrapsychic organization is that they're still fused with the mother, and that's painful. You see, we're meant to, just like the baby's meant to hatch out of the womb, okay? The baby's meant to be born, it would be painful to stay in the womb all the time. Psychologically, spiritually, mentally, right? If they're still fused like that in that little womb there, it'd be painful to stay in there. It's that similar idea. We're meant to grow up, right? We're born to grow up, right? Just like any bird becomes independent and they grow up, that kind of thing, right? Humans, same kind of thing, right? So normal development. So the baby does get the maternal holding environment. That means he gets his symbiotic needs met, the fusion met. He gets that egg, that warm egg, that extended womb. He gets that. Then let's say it's warm, it's good enough. That allows him to hatch out. So he starts to hatch out at 4 to 5 months. That's great. Now between 4 to 5 months and 18 months, there's a gradual dissipation of the infantile megalomania. So that him still thinking he's a little god is still there up until 18 months, but it gradually dissipates. Love affair with the world. The world is my oyster. Now, when the child has locomotion, when he can start to crawl and walk and run, you know, in the late, like 7 months or six, whatever, 8 months, 9 months, 10 months, whatever it is. Now he has a superpower now. He can run. All of the new powers now. I think a comparison is in that Spider-Man movie, when Spidey discovered his power. He can swing and from, he can swing from tower to tower, right? They showed a real emphasis on his pleasure and his happiness and swinging and wow, look at this, he can do this. I think they were echoing this idea of the baby when he learns to walk and run. New love affair with the world. So Spidey there, I'm talking about the one Andrew Garfield, 2012 or something, that one there. By the way, that movie with Spider-Man has a very good sentence at the very end. They closed that movie with the teacher telling her students that that literature, the heart and soul of literature is to help people know themselves. Okay? So that was a good little sentence there. We have it in the collection here. So anyways, so the baby can run around, love affair with the world, world is my oyster kind of thing. So he's running around. Now during that time, he wants to be seen, heard, and felt. Then he can see, feel himself. That helps. That's called mirroring. So he starts off with symbiosis, number one. Number two, mirroring. If he's mirrored, that's the theory. I still have some question marks personally about the whole mirroring phase, but let's say he's mirrored. Probably a sign that I wasn't mirrored, I guess. So let's say he's mirrored. Then he can see, feel himself. That helps him to differentiate. He needs to be mirrored to be able to differentiate if he has that identity. If he looks into his mother's eyes and he sees that the mother sees him, hears him, feels him, he can do those things for himself. So he needs the mirroring. Now, during that time, the mother sees that the child is unique and she's okay with that. And the child says, oh, I'm unique. Mother sees that I'm unique. Am I unique? Oh, cool. So now he's discovering his uniqueness. So let's say that doesn't take place. So that's the narcissistic pattern. It's going to still be there, right? A version of them. Maybe not as bad as there are a variety of narcissistic patterns to different degrees, different types of the narcissistic pattern. So that one there might not be that as hostile as the earlier one. There are different versions of the narcissistic pattern. So anyways, he'll have the narcissistic pattern. He wants to be seen. And he'll do it in a manner similar to the one who's too fused in the tar pit of a negative symbiosis and can't get out. So in a way, he's still stuck with the mother because he couldn't leave the mother if he's not seen by her. He needs to be seen by her to leave her. It's the same. It's an overlap. It works both ways. So if the baby isn't seen, he's still stuck in the tar pit of a negative symbiosis. Yeah. So let's say the baby is seen. Yeah. Seen, heard, and felt. Now he can differentiate. Now he knows himself. Now at 18 months, he's halfway differentiated. Yeah. Now he goes, whoa. Mother's a separate person, I'm a separate person? Oh, okay, I get it now. I see. Your mother's not just a thing to serve me, and she's like a person, and I'm like my own person? Whoa, okay, that's the next phase. So starting at 18 months, roughly, he's going to explore the world and learn, but he's gonna be scared at times. He'll run back to his mother, who's now functioning as a secure base. Now, when the baby runs back to his mother to touch base, so to speak, it's not for symbiosis. It's not even really to be seen that he's unique. He just wants a little bit of safety there because he's exploring further now and he needs to maybe touch base sometimes, but it's just very briefly. So then he'll explore further. Now he'll learn things about, he'll want to learn. Now he's learning. His learning curve is going, he's got thousands of questions. So he'll always run back to, oh, what does this mean? I found this, what's that, what's this? How do they make those towers there? What do you call those things, the green thing? What do you call that? What's that? And they'll go on and on like this. So the mother does her best to answer the questions, right? She's going to be like a little teacher there. It's called communicative matching. She's going to match the communicative interest of the child. And there's some kind of creative improv involved. The child says this, yeah. She says yes and. So she's kind of amping up and encouraging the child. During that phase, the child's going to look into his mother's eyes, and the child is thinking, you know, I'm really learning, I'm really going to become myself, and I'm really different from the mother, and I'm not really going to need her that much pretty soon. Is the mother going to be okay with that? Or is the mother going to freak out if I become too independent from her? So the child's got to see that the mother's okay with him becoming himself. So let's say that doesn't take place. Let's say the mother panics. Hey, wait a minute, little junior here is going to be not really going to need me anymore. Then she'll face separation anxiety because the child's autonomy will trigger her separation anxiety. So the mother might reward regression and punish autonomy. Maybe at that point, she says, stop. No, I'm not going to support this anymore. This has gone too far. So she's going to say, all right, baby, you're getting too... you're exercising your rights to grow and to know yourself. Well, that's kind of freaking me out because I don't want to be triggered of my memories of when I was a baby and I didn't get psychological autonomy. You're going to get psychological autonomy and I didn't? Well, that's going to heal intergenerational trauma. Well, she'd be very brave if she could offer that, right? So some mothers have become addicted to using their child as a mirror for her. Some mothers want the baby to mirror her because she wasn't mirrored when she was a child. Some mothers want that from their children. That's called the Jocasta style of mothering. So if things get complicated like that, the child still partially differentiated. He has some love and gratitude. Some love and gratitude have entered the psychological picture, but he's stuck there. He's sort of going to be like the... He still thinks that he's not okay. Okay, now that I'm okay, in the codependent pattern, he's still holding on to the original, I'm not okay, you're okay. So he's going to be the pleaser, the clinger, the codependent, very helpful types. Many of them work in the hospitality industry, serving others, that kind of thing. Now the earlier one, prior to 18 months, they couldn't hold on to the original, I'm not okay, you're okay. They kind of crossed over and identified with the aggressor. Now the aggressor was seen as okay, and they reject themselves as being not okay. Okay, their not okayness, they see onto others and say that they're not okay. Then they say, I'm okay, you're not okay. Now, trauma before 18 months, when they cross over and say, I'm okay, you're not okay. When they say you're not okay, they're talking about themselves seeing onto the other. and they're imitating their perception of the mother not thinking that the child was okay. You see? Now, let's say they get enough love post 18 months, they can still hold on to their true self. Even though the true self feels not okay, they can still hold on to it. So that they're a little bit better off in that way. Even though it's more painful consciously in their lives to think that, but it's more real for the development. Like, it's more normal for the development to be in that state where you think you're not okay and others are okay. But people who think that they're okay, people who say, I'm okay, you're not okay, the prejudice, a lot of prejudice from there. Yeah, that's a severe trauma, severe aberration that the mother was very shaming towards the baby, if that's the case. So if the trauma is between 18 months and 36 months, so-called rapprochement phase, so they're kind of in the middle there, the codependent pleaser types. They have some love and gratitude, and they're better in relationships. They have some empathy and care for others. So let's say the child does get the secure base, the communicative matching, the coaching, the improv, and he learns, and then he differentiates further at between 30 and 36 months, Margaret Mahler says. So now, with more differentiation, even further differentiation, he's really more himself. You know? He has a complex, nuanced sense of himself, and the other is a person in their own right, more fully. It's more fully established. That's, I'm okay, you're okay. Now love and gratitude have more fully entered the psychological picture. Now, with differentiation, that's normal development, they now have access to a prize, a huge reward, I guess, called the real self. It's a part of the self that becomes available to the child post-differentiation. Post-differentiation, the person has access to the real self part of the self. Okay? Now, the real self part of the self won't develop, won't flower and blossom if the child doesn't go through normal development. If he's frozen, stuck with the rest of development, stunted development, a fixation somewhere, frozen like the woolly mammoth, somewhere between, you know, birth and three, if he's stuck there, then he doesn't have access to the real self. So the goal is to get to the real self part of the self. So to get to the real self part of the self, we gotta look back and lift the thorn, free the woolly mammoth. Or in the kids' movie, Kirikou and the Sorcerers, the little Kirikou lifts the thorn from the woman's back and frees the woman. So we got to lift the anchor, got to lift the thorn, lift the thorn. Very good kids' movie called Kirikou and the Sorcerers, French animated film. Recommend that one, yeah. So that's called the mourning process. The mourning process. The truth will upset you free. So we got to look for the truth. The truth will bring up these emotions. Then we're set free. It's the truth that sets us free. Upsets us free. The truth will upset you free. That's one of the best things I've ever heard a comedian say. The truth will upset you free. So let's say the person does differentiate. Now he has the real self. Now, what are the capacities of the real self? How do we describe this real self part of the self? Well, Masterson lists 10 basic ideas here. Now, I'm not so sure if this is directly quoted from Masterson or if they've sort of paraphrased it a little bit. I didn't do the comparison here, but it does seem very similar to what Masterson wrote here. So here. This is a list of the capacities of the real self. With differentiation, we have access to the real self part of the self. Okay? Now, with differentiation, we have our feelings. That means when we have our feelings, we have joy and sadness have come back. So at the end of the movie, at the end of the Disney movie Inside Out, joy and sadness came back. That's a wide range of feelings between joy and sadness. We have a wide range of feelings. Aliveness of feelings, that's the vibrancy. Okay, if you look at the painting called Stepping Out by Roy Lichtenstein, you'll see that vibrancy and the aliveness of feelings. So we have the wide range and the vibrancy of feelings. That means a person can mourn losses. If they have the feelings, they can mourn losses, right? So that's the first capacity of the real self. Number one, the capacity to experience deeply a wide range of feelings, both pleasant and unpleasant. Okay. Yeah, this is Roberts's sort of abbreviated sort of paraphrasing of it. Okay. Yeah, this Masterson puts it a little different. I have the original Masterson quote about it. It's in the collection here. If you type in Masterson in the search engine and go through it, you'll find it. So this is Roberts's sort of abbreviated summary of it. So pleasant and unpleasant, because joy is the pleasant side. So the serene, inexhaustible fullness of being, there's the pleasant one, right? Enjoying the present, enjoying the sunset, you know, feeling that you're feeling real in the now. See, with trauma, our feelings are on hold. In the present, we feel like something, where's our feelings? So we're not really enjoying the present. We need our feelings to enjoy the present. Otherwise, we're sort of numb to the present. Just like the woolly mammoth is kind of numb in his state. So we feel kind of numb in the present. Now that's called living the provisional life, the unlived life, feeling that life is on hold. That woolly mammoth, his life is on hold. We feel like our lives are on hold when our feelings are in the bag. Now we get back the feelings when we resolve splitting and differentiate. Forgive the mother, resolve splitting, differentiate. So we have access to pleasant and unpleasant feelings. So the unpleasant feelings, that's the sad part. Now we can mourn losses. We can repair. We feel badly if a mistake happens, and we can make reparation. We can feel appropriate a guilt and want to make amends, that kind of thing. Someone said if you make a mistake, you got to repair it times four, whatever it was. So we have this capacity to experience deeply a wide range of needed appropriate feelings, the whole spectrum from the pleasant to the unpleasant. So that's the woolly mammoth. You feel the depth of your feelings. If we're reunited with our bodies, someone called the body the unconscious. Your whole body's the unconscious, someone said. That's quite a concept. I haven't figured that one out yet. But number two, now the capacity to expect appropriate entitlements, such as experiences of mastery and pleasure. So you don't feel guilty for success. You feel it's okay to enjoy your interests and to have mastery and pleasure. So you're not betraying anybody. If you're getting good at something, some people sabotage, I can't be good at this because that'll be disloyal to the mother. Because if I'm good at something, I'll be more autonomous. I won't need the mother. Mother will feel abandoned. But when I was a baby, mother couldn't accept my truth. She would have left me. Now I better sabotage my mastery to please the mother. Okay. Now when you forgive the mother, heal the splitting, differentiate, that's gone. You're okay. You don't feel guilty for being good at something. So you can develop your interests and your talents and have mastery and enjoy your new skill. That's a good one, right? Capacity for self-activation and self-assertion. Okay, real self-activation, including the ability to identify one's own unique individuality, wishes, dreams, and goals, and to be assertive in expressing them autonomously. So now you know your interests, you feel it's unique, and I like it, and you can protect it, and you don't feel guilty if it's a little different from others or something. Okay, next one here. The capacity for the acknowledgment of self-esteem, because one can't always depend on others to give them self-esteem. Oh yeah, this is a change from Masterson. Yeah, this is different. Masterson said there's a kind of a positive feedback loop. When you activate your real self and you accept it, that feeds your self-esteem naturally. This is not the narcissistic self-esteem. This is just your authentic self-esteem, because you have a self. When you differentiate, you have that sense of self. So to maintain that sense of self, when you express your real self, and you're good with that, that kind of fuels your natural self, sense of self. So there's a positive feedback loop. Doing something from the heart, it came from your heart. You see that, you take pleasure in that cycle. Yes, this is a paraphrase of Masterson. Okay, the ability to soothe painful affects. Right. So now, with differentiation, because we went through all that work to differentiate from the mother and forgive her, we did all that, we kind of created the ability to soothe ourselves. You see? Thanks to the big help of the caring witness. The caring witness helped us to develop new circuits so that we can soothe ourselves. So we don't have to binge eat. If we feel anxious, run to the fridge and gulp down some cookies or something. Right? The ability to make and follow through with commitments despite setbacks. Yeah, so as part of success, you have a plan, you make a commitment. Intimacy, you make a commitment. The setback, okay, you learn from it and keep going. That kind of thing. Next one here, the capacity for creativity. The ability to be creative in altering old familiar patterns of living and replacing them with new and more successful ones. I think what happens is when you heal from trauma, you can think better. You can get new ideas. So you're creative. With trauma, it damages your ability to think. Think about that quote we had earlier about school shock. The poor kid never felt safe with his mother. Then she threw him into the kindergarten, and the child actually thought he lost his mother. So he was in a shock. He didn't understand that the mother's still there for him. He was confused about it. So he felt the shock in the new environment of the school, and he disassociated and daydreamed the whole time, and he couldn't think, he couldn't concentrate. The teacher labeled him as having a learning disability. He didn't have a learning disability. He was just disassociated from the shock trauma of losing his mother, from his perception, you see. So when we heal trauma, we can think and concentrate, and we can read and those kinds of things, right? That's a pretty good underappreciated quote, the one about school shock. You know? A lot of kids are daydreaming, staring out the window, waiting for the bell to ring. They can't listen, they can't concentrate, they're overwhelmed. So just sitting in the classroom, they feel scared. So they're daydreaming to not feel the pain of being separated from the mother, because they think, are they losing the mother? They're too far away from the mother. They don't have the memory of a good mother being as a part of them or something. So they can't soothe themselves during the stress of some mediocre teacher or something. They should be able to get some benefit even from a mediocre teacher. They should still want to have that filtering process where they, well, what's the message here? What can we learn here? That kind of thing. The capacity for intimacy. So they can make I statements. Intimacy is the mutuality of the I'm okay, you're okay. Of course they're intimate, because they're not going to project the trauma of the rejecting mother onto the other and say, I love you, you're perfect, now change. And the other's not doing the same thing on them, and then they're constantly arguing with each other because they're constantly reenacting their childhood in the present with the other. And the other one is reenacting their childhood in the present with the other. So they're both reenacting their painful childhoods in the present, and they're both trying to get the other to change in the fantasy that the changed person can change their past. It can't be done, right? So that's not going to be intimate. These marriages rust out. It leads to sour milk. It can't be done. Now, intimacy is, you have the foundation of yourself, they have the foundation of themselves, and they can share and make I statements. So when there is a misunderstanding or a confusion, they can make I statements. So we have a major thread on how to make an I statement. TQ 23, is it 60? Look up Susan Campbell. A very good example of how to make an I statement called the unilateral repair statement. Or better yet, just read her book directly. It's called From Triggered to Tranquility. Susan Campbell. But we have it in our collection here. I think it's 2360. Yeah, I think that's the one. TQ 2360. TQ, therapy quote number 2360. It's an example. It's a quote from her book on how to make an I statement. And I've given a few examples already about it. So couples can make I statements. Or you read Marshall Rosenberg's book, Language of Life, NBC. He has a thing called OFNR, O-F-N-R, an acronym, observation, that's the trigger, feelings and needs from childhood and the request in the present. That's another way to make an I statement. So we have two very good models on how to make an I statement. So couples can make I statements. When two people make I statements, they're sharing their vulnerability with each other. That's a brave thing to do. That means you trust the other. The other's caring for you and you're caring for them. So you love that. You love sharing your truth with each other and knowing each other. It you get closer and safer. You understand each other more. Now you can be creative together. So I statements, that's intimacy. And then when you do that, there's this magical, people talk about this magical feeling of an us. Now there's this sort of third feeling of an us. So there's the two of them, and there's the feeling of the us. Now the us supports the two of them. So they're actually both growing and getting healthier and happier by the usness of the two of them. And they're protecting the usness kind of thing. And they're both growing with it. Okay, the capacity for intimacy, which requires the capacity for entering into a close and open relationship with another person with a minimal experience of abandonment and engulfment. Okay? Abandonment and engulfment. That's the dysfunctional, that's the insecure attachment style. The child felt either abandoned or impinged upon. If that's unresolved, they're going to project these two fears into the present. You're going to be too demanding on me. You're going to be too bossy. You're going to be too abandoned. You're going to be too neglecting. Too abandoning. So they're both triggered from the childhood intrapsychic experience. So a lot of pain that we're feeling is a re-triggering of an old experience that we forgot. Something in the present can trigger what we went through as a child but repressed. Now it's coming up because it's being re-triggered. So if you're angry at somebody in the present, in your interpersonal relationship, direct all that back to the parent. That's what Kiesen says, Morton Kiesen. TQ 2391-3, Morton Kiesen, K-I-S-S-E-N. That's a good quote there about that. Okay, number nine, the ability to be alone. To be alone without feeling abandoned. So there's the solitude you enjoy, you can be with yourself. Because the baby could be himself in the presence of his mother, and the mother accepted his presence. Now he can do it for himself, because he has that wiring within, that it's safe to be himself. So he was alone, and he was comfortable in the presence of his mother. Now he can do it for himself, right? So there's the solitude area. There's the area of solitude. The last one here, the continuity one. So I'll leave that last one there for another time. Okay, so real self-activation. What Masterson refers to as real self-activation, quote, the capacity to identify one's unique individuative wishes and to use autonomous initiative and assertion to express them in reality and to support and defend them as needed. So that's real self-activation. So the baby was real in the beginning. Hey, mommy, I want to bond to you. Oh, you reject my wish. Hey, mommy, I have these feelings. That's real self. Ooh, rejected. So that's a template. So Masterson's axiom is based on this. Real self-activation will trigger the abandonment depression by the mother. All that rejection, the shame, rage by the mother. And then when a person feels a lot of pain, they use a defense mechanism to squelch the pain or to distract them away from it. So they'll blame others. So blaming others, projection, distracts you from the pain from within. If you think others are the cause of your pain, then your mind is outward and your attention is outward. So Masterson's axiom is self-activation triggers abandonment depression, which leads to defense. It all stems from the original. The baby had a self-activation, a wish and a need. That got rejected. The child felt abandonment depression. That's an umbrella term for a wide range of feelings, pain, shame, rage, helplessness, hopelessness, powerlessness, all that stuff, right? So That's called abandonment depression, persecutory anxiety, the screen painting, etc. I don't use that other term that some authors like to use, but I'm not sure how helpful it is. But it's the feeling that the child might not make it. They call it annihilation anxiety. I don't like that phrase. It's the feeling that the child might not make it. If the baby doesn't see his mother, poof, the baby might think there is no mother, that she's gone forever. The baby doesn't understand time. He only lives in the moment now, right? He doesn't understand, everything is just this nowness. He doesn't understand past, present, future. He doesn't understand that kind of thing. So if the mother's not there, what, there's no mother? The baby can't survive if there's no mother. So what do we call that anxiety? There is a phrase for it. I don't really like it. I'm just sticking with the general phrase, persecutory anxiety. So the child feels sort of persecuted by this feeling. That's called persecutory anxiety, right? Or the abandonment. So the abandonment depression includes persecutory anxiety. So self-activation triggers. So later on in later life, if we try to do something autonomous from our heart, real self, something we want to do, something that's good for us, something that's right for us, that's like a real self-activation. So we get a glimpse, sometimes we get a glimpse of our real self, doing something that feels, oh, I think this is unique to me, I like this. This is something I want to do. Often it's just that you want to heal, usually, or anything. So that's real self-activation. Okay, boom, it's going to trigger what happened in the nursery. In the nursery, the child felt abandonment depression. So real self-activation in the present now is going to trigger that old feeling of abandonment depression. So now, as in the now, when we feel that all that anxiety, massive anxiety, often we can't hold it, so we're going to run to the fridge and wolf down a box of cookies or something. Trigger our brain to send us serotonin. So you binge eat on the sugar, sugar, salt, and fat. The brain sends you serotonin. You feel soothed by the serotonin because you couldn't soothe yourself, you see. You haven't achieved the differentiation. Differentiation, you can do something real and not feel anxious about it, not feel guilty about it. And we're not talking about doing something that hurts others. On the contrary, real self-activation helps everyone, themselves and others. It's a generative kind of thing. Huh? The thing about the candles, you light your candle, that helps others to light their candle. It's a positive thing for everyone, right? When a person's true to themselves, kind of thing. Doesn't someone being authentic is not going to be at someone else's expense. If it is at somebody else's expense, it's not authentic. It's schadenfreude. It's communicating that the mother got some benefit from the child at the child's expense. So they're replaying that dynamic. The mother objectified the child. She got some benefit by this. They objectified, they shame others. That's not real self-activation. Real self-activation is an expression of your uniqueness. It has nothing to do with hurting others. If it does, right, that's not real self-activation. No way, right? So, do we have that here? Hold on a second. I think we have a quote related to this here, coming up. Hold on a second. Yeah, here it is, here. Yeah, the Roberts, they sort of summarize it this way. Okay, the disorders of the self triad. Okay, the disorders of the self triad. So that had three parts, what I just mentioned. Self-activation, part one. Triggers abandonment depression, part two. Which leads to defense, part three. So that's a triad. This triad is very common in dysfunctional living. Now, in dysfunctional living, his jargon is, it means you have a disorder of yourself. The self has been disordered, like disadvantaged. It's frozen. It's a disorder. It's a problem with the self. I'm not perfectly comfortable with the phrase disorder of the self. Maybe a damage of the self or something. A damage of the self triad or something like that. Dysfunction of the self triad, something like that. Any experience or expression of the real self, even wanting to heal, right, will evoke separation anxiety or an abandonment depression. The experience is followed by defenses that mute the misery of the ensuing emotional pain. Succinctly stated, self-activation leads to an abandonment experience, which leads to defense. Yeah, so there's Roberts's sort of a paraphrase or slightly abridged version of Masterson's axiom. Self-activation leads to an abandonment experience, which leads to defense. This sequence can be seen repeatedly in the treatment hour, and it haunts the daily lives of our clients. So we need to be a detective. A psychotherapist becomes a type of psychological detective looking for, okay, this axiom. Looking for absent content. Now, the mother who cannot attune regularly to the real self-experience of her child is also likely not to be able to provide consistent repair experiences following relational disruptions. Her child will not internalize the expectation or experience that reunion, i.e. restoration of the attachment, will occur after rupture. Her child will not internalize the expectation that reunion or restoration of the attachment will occur after rupture. Okay, it's worth noting, right? If there is a rupture, if the baby does have a rupture with the mother and the mother is able to repair it, later on, that can manifest that if a relationship breaks up, well, maybe they can talk about it and repair. But back in the nursery time, if there is a rupture and it never got repaired, later on, if there's an attachment and then there's some kind of rupture, it can't be repaired. They're replaying the template that when the rupture is there with the mother, later on in relationships, if there's a rupture, it can't be repaired. So they expect that it can't be repaired. And they want to prove that it can't be repaired because they want to be loyal to the mother because the mother didn't repair it. So if the couple breaks up, neither of them, maybe they both have this and they both might think, well, it's done, can't repair it. That's a mirror to know that when they had a rupture with the mother, that the mother couldn't repair it. So the mother's got to repair it. It's called rupture and repair. The mother has to repair it. That becomes a wiring. Later on, if there is a problem in the marriage, they can repair it. They can talk to someone. They can do things. They can repair it. It's called rupture and repair. So if a person never thinks anything can be repaired, meaning, you know, reunited with the spouse or something, that's because, as a child, the mother didn't offer the repair after the rupture. The mother who cannot attune, okay, she's misattuned, malattuned, doesn't get the baby's signals. Okay, so there it is again, Carl Menninger's quote, the greatest hurt of all, mother failed me. That's the misattunement. The mother who cannot attune regularly to the real self-experiences of her child is also likely not to be able to provide consistent repair experiences following relational disruptions. Her child will not internalize the expectation or the template or the script or the experience that reunion with the mother, i.e. restoration of the connection, will occur after rupture. So maybe let's say a couple does break up. One of them thinks it can be repaired because they had the experience it can be repaired. One of them thinks, no, once it's broken, it's done, you know. Actually, it's a huge healing opportunity to learn why it got broken, and it's an opportunity to get stronger. That's the metaphor of that vase, that little cup that gets broken, then they glue it together, and then the light shines through that glued part, and it's a very beautiful glass. So the cup that's broken, that's been repaired, actually sometimes looks even more artistic and beautiful than the original one. That's the metaphor for this area here. That's often used in self-help books for this part. Okay, so we talked about the triad. Do you remember the triad? The disorders of the self triad, Masterson's axiom. Self-activation, meaning real self-activation. Okay. Now, what's real self-activation?
Okay.
It is, back to here, the capacity to identify one's unique individuative. You're going to be individual, your uniqueness, right? The capacity to identify one's unique individuative wishes and to use autonomous initiative and assertion to express them in reality and to support and defend them as needed. So that's real self-activation. Okay? You identify one's unique individuative wishes, something that relates to your individuation, something that's unique for you. Everybody is nature's greatest miracle. So there's the poem by the self-help author Ogmandino, and called The Scroll Marked Number 4, Nature's Greatest Miracle. So there's a joy to express our unique individuative. Okay, and then so back to the axiom. So that's real self-activation. That's going to trigger the original abandonment depression. That's the template. And whenever there's massive anxiety, persecutory anxiety, the furies, a person's going to use some defense mechanism, some trick of the mind, some operation of the mind, some maneuver of the mind, some mechanism of the mind to not feel that anxiety. It's called a defense mechanism. So prejudice is a defense mechanism, obviously. Blaming others, projection, acting out, right? Identification with the aggressor, negative magic gesture, cynicism. The list goes on and on. There's quite a few things that people do. The manic defense. Some of it's more benign. You just Marion Woodman said she would just manically clean her house. And she said she had the cleanest house on the block, you know, when she got triggered. So she was sublimated her anger that way, right? Something useful. So if there is trauma way early on, before 18 months, and the fusion is still there, and the child didn't get the love to leave the mother, that means he's overly bonded to the frightening mother. So that image of the frightening mother is a devouring monster that wants to eat him. He can't accept that as his mother, so he denies it, and hallucinates that the mother's a goddess breast. And the ideal breast is goddess, heavenly, supreme, loving, all knows you, all sees you, there for you, unconditional love for you. He's going to hallucinate a perfect, beautiful breast. That's his mother. Remember, the baby's first mother is the breast mother, the breastfed. He doesn't fully see the mother as a separate, full, individual person. He's just sort of relating to this breast mainly. And it's amorphous. He doesn't get, it's all blurred there, right? So the breast mother. So he manufactures a breast mother as being wonderful. When in reality, he's relating to a shaming, a painful breast. Now the image of the painful breast is the monster that wants to eat him. Again, the baby projects his rage onto the image of the mother. So he thinks the mother's enraged. He projects his needs to take in onto the mother and thinks that the mother wants to take him in. Now the mother's the giantess in the nursery compared to the helpless infant. Now you have this enraged monster that wants to eat him. That's the image that he creates. He's going to deny that and make up another one, like the guy in the desert who hallucinates. That's called the splitting mechanism. So in the template, it's goddess and demon inside. Now that's just temporary. All babies very temporarily use this mechanism to cope with the situation. It's meant to get resolved before 4 months. That's only allowed, or it's only meant to take place within the first 4 to 5 months. If it isn't resolved, whoa, then splitting is still being used. Okay, if splitting is still being used, he's very enraged because differentiation didn't take place. The woolly mammoth, he's frozen, his feelings are frozen if splitting is still being used. Now he wants to communicate that he's still using splitting. Now how does he communicate or create a mirror that he's still using splitting? Okay, he does it through either or thinking, idealization, devaluation. Right? Now there's the prejudice comes from there. Right? He'll think because the goddess and demon template leads to either or, that leads to us, them, that kind of thing. Either them or us, that kind of thing. So that's a mirror to note that the splitting defense mechanism is still being used. So anybody with a I'm good, you're no good, that kind of, us or them, anybody with that mentality, they're still using the splitting mechanism. So prejudice is a mirror that they're still using the splitting mechanism. The splitting mechanism means that the person as a baby didn't get enough love to have the splitting resolved. With love, the splitting is resolved. The two sides come together and the form of image of the mother as one whole person. Not goddess and demon as separate entities in their psyche. That's trauma to have that. You see? So they're splitting. And when they're splitting, that means there's two there, goddess and demon. He's going to project one or the other. Okay? He can identify with one, project the other, do it simultaneously, flip it around. So let's say he has the shame self. Now, related to the rejecting monster image of himself, he's got the shame self. Okay, so there's a relational unit. So there's the last video about relational units. So the relational unit is you got a shaming mother and the child felt shamed. Okay, so he's going to reenact that to communicate it, to communicate what his mother did to him. So his shame self, he's going to see onto others, identify with the shamer, shame them to communicate that his mother shamed him. And this is a mirror to see what's within. So his interpersonal relationship is a mirror to see his intrapsychic situation. Okay. So that's a prejudice can come from that, because you're going to find a non-threatening substitute other, someone who's safe, peaceful, safe, however it is that you feel that they're safe. So somehow they're safe to you. So you're going to see your safe, you're going to see your child innocence. Yeah? The baby was safe to the mother, right? So you're going to see your safe innocence onto the safe substitute other. Shame them to communicate that your mother shamed you. Yeah? So there's a projection, negative magic gesture. Yeah? Now, you want to coax the other. Now, while you're shaming the other, you're hocus-pocus, double-focus, because of the fusion. You think the one you're shaming is shaming you. Now, you want to coax the other to be bad so you can, to be rejecting. You want to prove that they're rejecting to replay that the mother rejected you. While you're shaming them, you want to prove that they're shaming you. Right? So now you want to coax them to show something unpleasant toward you, and you want to coax them. So you give them the identity of the shamer. While you're shaming them, you give them that identity, because ultimately you want to replay that the mother shamed you. So you want to coax, taunt, do something, interact with them in a way, kind of pull them, so to speak, induce them to do something shaming towards you. Then you go, aha, that's a communication that the mother shamed you. Yeah? So a lot of this activity, based on splitting, projection, the coaxing, projective identification, the hocus pocus, double focus, preserving the infantile megalomania, feeling important while you're doing it because you're actively doing it now, being loyal to the mother because you are her, because you need her, and so you are her. You're protecting her because you're not directly expressing your anger at the mother, you're doing it sideways. A lot of this activity can lead to prejudice. Right? So, splitting, projection, projective identification, and denial are detrimental to the perception of reality, and for this reason are maladaptive. The ability to tolerate a realistic view of others makes such wholesale defenses less necessary. Okay, so these are archaic, primitive defense mechanisms. These are infantile, very immature babyhood mechanisms. These kinds of prejudice is an infantile, archaic, raw, archaic, babyhood persecutory rage feeling. This is a raw, archaic defense mechanisms that the baby adopts, tricks of the mind that the baby adopts to deal with the pain of thinking that he's not going to make it if the mother's shaming him or abandoning him or something, right? Splitting, projection, projective identification, denial. Okay, it's going to distort reality to replay that script with the mother. This is maladaptive to him because he's not healing. Now, the positive intention of his efforts is to communicate, to create a mirror for him to see what happened to him. Doing to others is a replay or a reenactment of what the mother did to him. But he's playing the role of the mother this time, and others are substituting for his innocence. So prejudice can come from that, you see. So if we see others realistically, that means differentiation. We don't use that. We lose all of those defense mechanisms, become existential hearsay. With the forgiveness and the mourning process, All those archaic defense mechanisms become existential hearsay. They're dropped. They're no longer needed. In the story, the king white bear Valamon, that boar woman, the husks, she falls down the thing, right? So that means it disappears. It dissipates, right? It's not a loss of an actual character. We'll talk about that one there tomorrow, about that one. Okay, related to this one, primitive processes of splitting and projective identification. Okay, distorted perceptions. Okay, so this is scapegoating and stereotyping of the individual. Okay, now this can become prejudice in a group. So this leads to prejudice. So this is some of this inner psychology of prejudice, this primitive process of the splitting, coaxing others, misperceiving others, that leads to scapegoating and stereotyping. That we call that prejudice, because you're treating others badly, thinking badly of others, but all you're doing is trying to communicate that you as a baby felt that you were treated badly and thought of badly by your mother. This is a misperception. The mother just made a mistake. It's not her fault. If she herself didn't get a secure attachment style, because if she didn't get a secure attachment style, she's in a battle with her mother in the mind. So the mother might be shaming her own child to communicate to her mother that she didn't like how her mother shamed her. So she's trying to communicate what happened to her by shaming her own child. That's the compulsion to express her anger at her own mother and at the same time protect her, because she's not directing her anger at her own mother. So the solution, Morton Keeson says, is you got to direct your anger towards the mother, not towards your baby. That's intergenerational trauma if you put it on the baby. You got to put it back to the true source, up to the mother. You see? Now the mother, the truth will upset you free. Because the mother will, if you confront your mother, she'll just replay what she did to you in childhood. She'll gaslight you, shame you, what are you talking about, and guilt trip you, I gave you life, say these kinds of things, look what I went through, do you know my story? Wait a minute, we're talking about me here then, for the moment. So she hasn't done her work, so she's just still trying to be seen herself. So the person might say, okay, so let's talk about you then, so what happened to you? I see, so then maybe the child can be a caring witness. That's what the mother wants. They want the son or the daughter to be a therapist for them or something. They want to be healed. They're looking for healing. They want to be seen. That kind of thing, right? So maybe everybody should be therapists. Maybe we should all be trained on how to be a therapist so we can heal our parents and heal intergenerational trauma. Psychoanalysis is the investigation of the self's connection or link to its internal objects. Okay? So we want to link the outer and the inner. How the outer is an expression of the inner. The dialogue of the analytic pair is conscious and deals at first with the manifest content of the link. But the analyst observes the expression of this link in the transference situation and looks beyond to the link's latent content. Sun's clearing up there. So the job of the therapist is to make a link between the reenactment of the past and the present, to see the present and to see how it's an expression, to see what's going on in the present, to see that it's an expression of the past and to make that link. So the main link we're looking for is the person's pattern in life, when it began, and then to see it in the here and now, in the transference live, and to make that three link, the link there. That's called a total interpretation or a complete interpretation. It's got to be presented at the right time, in the right way. It's a real craft and an art and a skill for someone to offer somebody a complete interpretation like that. So one example of it was in the movie I Love Huckabees, a comedy film. I don't recommend the film per se, but I would say watch it for that scene of the interpretation. There is an interpretation in that film. The three therapists there, they call themselves existential detectives or psychological detectives. They said to this guy, Albert, you know, you have this pattern in your life where you're betraying yourself, you're self-defeating yourself. and where did you learn this? So they went to the childhood house, literally, and they said, here's where you learned it. Here's where you learned it. You were betrayed by the mother. Right? And that's why in the present, now you're encrypting the truth. He doesn't want to get in touch with his truth, his real self. So he's encrypting it, encoding it, and talking about it in some veiled way. And he's not aware of his true self anymore. That's why he's hiding from himself. Now he's betraying himself to stay loyal to the mother who betrayed him. The mother betrayed him. He betrays himself to stay loyal to the mother who betrayed him. Why is he doing this over and over again? Because he's got to stay loyal to her and attached to her, because he's waiting for her to change her ways so she can provide the love that he needs so he can leave and know himself. Now that's not going to happen, but that's why he's doing it again and again and again. That's why in that movie we saw in the introduction to that movie, running down the corridors and running down the hallways, desperately searching for someone who can help him. So he went down and found the therapist finally. It's a comedy film, man. Because he feels the pain of doing this over and over again, and he knows he's stuck. He wants help. He can't see it. So that's why it's helpful to have someone else point it out to you. Okay, you're doing this thing because you learned it in childhood, and that's why in the present you're doing this thing. And it helped, right? So that's called an interpretation. Sorry if I seem a little manic today in my video. I noticed today I'm a little more anxious today. I thought the coffee would kind of... I don't know if the coffee made it worse or not, but let me take a little stretch here. Hold on a sec. Maybe it's the safety of this room that's making me, bringing stuff up in me. Yeah, sorry I can't show you too much in this video, being in this room here. Let's see. How's it down there? You know, maybe, ironically, maybe now I can go. Let's see. See, ironically, now, had I started the video now, I could use the pool. I could move down. Let's see, what is it here? 4 o'clock. It's an odd, sweet time when things are quiet around here. There's still staff, but they're not as animated. Should I go down? How are we doing here? Okay, let's just finish it here then. That's okay. A major threat. So these two quotes here, the one by Roberts and the other one by Hinshelwood, they both are going to be added to our thread on the psychology of prejudice. So trauma creates, prejudice is a symptom of trauma, for sure. And it's a communication that the person has trauma. Prejudice is an expression of infantile, desperate maneuvers of the mind that the baby uses and still uses because of trauma. So prejudice is a mirror that there's trauma. Okay, this one can help also clarify why the baby creates an image in his mind of his rejecting mother as a devouring monster that wants to eat him. So this next one is partially related to it. The infant projects his rage and fear and pain around unmet needs into the mother to get rid of these unpleasant affects and stop them from disturbing the good and lively parts of his self. Okay, so here we go. So the baby feels rage, fear, pain around the mother. He can't feel these feelings. These feelings, he puts it onto the mother. Now he sees the mother. He creates an image of the mother that embodies his own pain, shame, and rage. So the image he creates is the devouring monster that wants to eat him. Again, the baby has called what's called primary process thinking, pictorial thinking. Right? So the image the baby creates. So myths and fairy tales describe this primary process thinking. So in the bag, that's primary process thinking. No time in there. Pictorial, wildly exaggerated. Myths and fairy tales. Alice in Wonderland. Morphing, condensation, displacement. Hocus pocus, doublethink, negative magic gesture, splitting, projective identification. A lot of these things are, that's called primary process thinking. Now our conscious, reasonable present, that's called secondary process thinking. We want to move as much as possible. We want to witness as much as possible. We want to witness this to bring a lot of the underlying material back into consciousness to soothe ourselves, because that's a lot of pain still going on in there. Our inner child is in pain back in there, right? The infant misidentifies his own feelings as coming from his mother. So the child now misidentifies it. It's his own feelings and rage, puts it onto the mother, and misidentifies the source, the source of these feelings. It's not from his mother, it's from him. He misidentifies it. That's called projection. Projection, you misidentify. Oh, there's a new one there. Projection. We misidentify the source. When we project, we misidentify the source. The source belongs to the projector. This causes him the same kind of pain that he were to feel if he didn't project. Huh? So if he didn't project, he feels persecutory. When he projects it, he feels he's being persecuted. Same idea by the mother. The infant copes by taking it in and then splitting and repressing this monster aspect of the mother. With trauma, the bad object is split off and dominant, and that is what the infant is attached to. That is what the infant is attached to, even if it's unhealthy. So the baby is attached to this monster. You see? That's the truth, and he denies it. There's dysfunction, and he's going to be loyal to it. Next one. Defense mechanisms protect the ego from having to be constantly conscious of the reality that the ego is not the center of who we are, just the center of what we are aware. That's a good little reminder. So we've got the conscious ego. Our conscious ego, that's the center of what we're aware of. What we're not aware of, it has an ego. That's the unconscious ego. Now this unconscious ego is very powerful. It has a mind, so the unconscious has a mind of its own. So all of our disowned traits, everything about us that's in this bag, if we were to amalgamate all of our own unknown traits and in some kind of metaphysical imagining, create some kind of character that makes up all of these disowned traits and make up this character, that's called the double self. It's us. Sometimes called the secret self, the second self, the unconscious self, the shadow soul. Daryl calls it the skeleton. You don't see it. It's the one who walks with us, who's not like us, who is us. Someone's living my life and I know nothing about him. Okay. So the idea is you want to have a dialogue with this double self and realize that this double is you. So you want to own what you see in the double and accept it. So we've been talking about the phantom of the opera. She went into the basement, the unconscious, meaning facing her double self. That phantom dude character with the mask, that's an aspect of her double self. It's not some separate character. It's a metaphor for the internal. Okay? So she's getting in touch with her pain, shame, and rage, and she's befriending her own feelings. And when she owns her own feelings, she went back up on stage and was a better singer. So she was more integrated, more whole when she accepted herself. So we're better off when we accept our feelings. Feeling is healing. We want to find our feelings. Repetition, compulsion, and reenactment takes place because we lost our feelings. And we're looking for them. We repeat because we're looking for our feelings. We repeat because we lost our feelings. When we find our feelings, we stop repeating, Russell says. And we did a lot, and the last one was about becoming our own detective. The therapist becomes a type of psychological detective looking for hidden motives. Okay? Unconscious motives, repetition compulsion, schemas, obscured fantasies, that's schemas, templates, missing data, okay, absent content, okay, the unknown known, we're looking for the unknown known, make the unconscious conscious, we become a psychological detective. How are we doing here? Well, maybe I'll start to wind this video down here. And I hope, despite my anxious, I'm a little, my delivery was definitely a little anxious today. I'm not sure why I'm feeling a little anxious today. And I think the coffee made it worse. You know, part of me thought, okay, today's coffee's extra strong. They made it too strong. A different clerk made it. A different barista made it, part of me. I thought, okay, well, that's okay. Maybe that'll be good. Maybe I'll be a little more alert. But it had the opposite effect on me. It pained me, and it made me a little numbish. And I felt a little numbish during this video. And as I'm a little numbish, I noticed I slurred a few words here and there, because I'm kind of not present anymore. So it was too much. So too much caffeine pains me. And then the endorphins kick in. And now that caused that kind of blurring in my speech a little bit. So I was sort of blurring and slurring a few of the words a little bit. So too much stimulation has a negative effect on me. Yeah. So I won't, if I see that same barista, I'll, I'll ask them to ease up on the concentration of the caffeine there. But not like yesterday's video. I think there's some good quotes here as well. The capacities of the real self. So we talked about the 10 capacities. Masterson's axiom. What is self-activation? The rupture repair one. The needs of the parent will overwhelm the needs of the child, and the child will accommodate. He'll give himself up for the attachment. Then he'll create a script about that. We talked about the axiom. We talked about a little bit about prejudice, not that much. So if we reenact the trauma with the mother in the present, and transference is sometimes called transference, transferring the present into the past into the present, so that the present is a new version of the past. So we talked a bit about that, and the goal is to be aware of it, just to be aware of it. And we did a preview for the next video. So the next video is also not bad. Some of the feelings around the grief work process. How it's unhelpful to just use some kind of cliche or protective platitude. Get over it. Don't cry. Okay, that's because the witness, the listener, is uncomfortable. He's triggered, so he wants to squelch it. Protective identification. We talked one about that. So we spent a bit of time on that. The mother was bossy. They see the friend. Wait a minute, you a little bit reminded me of my mother when you said that. So they're gonna believe that the friend is gonna be bossy. So they're just gonna reenact it. So they'll be passive. That coaxes the other, that induces the other maybe to be bossy. And he goes, aha, he replayed it. Now the friend might say, hey, you're coaxing me to be bossy. Did you have a bossy mother? So a conscious friend might say that, right? A bit on transference. Okay, the fairy tale, the one with Robert Bly. Should I attempt it here or wait for tomorrow? Yeah, we'll wait for tomorrow about that one. So we'll do a little bit about Valamon. So Merriam Woodman and Robert Bly often like to tell the story about the white bear called Valamon. It's a good story. It's a good story. It's a very good story, yeah. So one part of it is the youngest daughter of three was in the field, and she saw this white bear playing with this golden reef, this very beautiful golden reef. And the woman felt something about it. So that's a trigger that she was connecting to herself, her real self activation. The gold is part of the real self. So she was getting a glimpse of the glimmering of the real self. But the glimmering of the real self is connected to the bear. Now that bear is like the woolly mammoth frozen in the block of ice. See, the mammal, or that strong mammal. Any kind of strong mammal, it's like a metaphor for our embodiment, our own embodiment that we're missing. So the white bear was the embodiment that we're missing. But if we have it, we have the glimmer of the gold, because then we can shine our true self, kind of thing. So the youngest daughter saw the glimmering. So the story is, she saw the glimmering with the bear, and she said to the bear, meaning to herself, again, this is not an external story, this is a metaphor for the internal dynamics. So the internal dynamics is the person has a glimpse of their animated and the glimpse inwardly, right? But in order to talk about this internal thing, we create a story outward to refer to the inward. So myths and fairy tales are outer stories that are metaphors for the inner journey. So let's just stick to the story then. The young lady says, hey bear, I like this golden reef here. Can I have it? He says, what do you have to offer? Oh, I can give you some money for it. What does a bear need money for? Oh, okay, you don't want the money? Well, I'll give you I'll give you a condo or something. A bears don't need condos. So she said, what do you want? The bear said, well, I want us to be together. The girl said, you mean we're going to get married? Well, yeah, that's how it works. She said, okay, because she wants her embodiment. She wants the sparkling of the real self, kind of thing. So the story is that they're engaged. They want to get married, right? So the woman goes back to the castle and tells her family about the story that they're going to get married. Now the father, again, that's not a separate character. That's just a part of her that's resisting it. So there's a part of her that's going to resist it. Okay, self-activation triggers the massive anxiety, and then when there's anxiety, we use a defense mechanism to prevent the feelings, re-owning of our feelings. So the king there orders the staff there, if you see this white bear, you know, just scare him off or something. That's the resistance. So the white bear came to meet to greet the daughter, and the staff, the sentries or whatever, tried to scare him off, and the white bear scared them off. So he roared or something and swatted away their tools or whatever. So the white bear approaches the castle to pick up his fiance, and the father steps forward the father gathers up the three daughters and says, oh, the bear is here. Gee, well, daughters, the custom in our land is that the oldest marries first. So you're the oldest, so you go out and marry the bear. Again, all metaphor, right? So the oldest daughter greets the bear. The bear says, oh, good. Okay, hop on the back. So now the oldest daughter's riding on the back of Valamon, the bear, right? The white bear. And the bear, while they're riding back, the bear asks her, have you ever felt more comfortable in your life? And the oldest thought, oh yeah, of course, yeah, with my dad. When I'm playing with my dad, I feel more comfortable. Have you ever seen more clearly in your life? Oh yeah, when I'm with my dad and I sit on his shoulders, I see more clearly. The bear bumps her and shrugs and bumps her off his back. It's not the right one, right? And the poor girl has to scurry on back to the castle or something. So the next day, the bear comes again. So this time the king sends out the middle daughter. Same thing happens. The next day he comes back. Now the youngest one sits on the back and he asks her the same questions. Have you ever ridden more comfortably, more softly? Have you ever ridden more comfortably than this now? She said, no, this is it. I'm very comfortable here. Have you ever seen more clearly than you do now? Oh no, I see clearly now. I feel comfortable and I see clearly. Aha, that's the right one. That's like a metaphor for accepting ourselves, accepting our feelings, accepting our embodiment. So they go back to the bear's place of dwelling, and the bear says, look, you know, at nighttime, you know, something's gonna happen, and I don't want you to look, or don't light a candle or anything. Okay, she says, so she agrees, and everything works well. The relationship is, in other words, she's comfortable with herself, so she's healing, she's connected to herself. But one day, she gets some anxiety, and she disobeys the thing, and scares off the, so she did something to scare off the bear, and the bear took off. Oh, you wrecked it. So she betrayed herself at some point, but she had a glimpse of herself, but she betrayed herself because it's difficult. So the bear ran up the glass mountain, and the daughter was in a real panic, and she tried to chase after the bear to find the bear, because that's herself, that's her soul, right? The bear is her soul, right? So she ran after the bear, and she asked everybody, did you see this white bear run off? And they don't know. Finally, she gets some help. She gets some help from some people, and she's even given some gifts because she's kind now, because she had the experience of the bear, her soul. So she's a kinder person. So she kind of gets some help from some people in the process. And finally, she learned that, the bear ran up that glass ice mountain. It's way at the top there. But you got to be careful because I heard that the bear is going to get married with the boar queen. That's the mother complex. That means if the daughter doesn't find the bear, she's not going to separate and know herself. So she wants to find the bear. So she finally climbs up the glass mountain after some, takes a while, but she finally climbs up the glass mountain and wants to see the bear. But the boar queen, that's the mother complex, that's the rejecting mother complex. Remember, the mother complex just means the baby created an image of the mother as a monster. So this boar woman was that image, right? So the image, you face the image, and you want to find yourself. So the boar queen said, what, you want to meet the bear? You want to, well, you got to pay for that or something. So she made a deal. So she worked it out where she could visit. She placated the boar queen and was able to visit the white bear. But the queen was very suspicious, so she gave wine to the bear, who's the handsome prince, of course, right, by now. A symbol for connecting with herself. And the boar queen said to Valamon, okay, hey, why don't you drink this red wine here? But it's a sleeper, so the guy goes to sleep. So the woman visits Valamon, but he's already asleep. She tries to wake him up. He's kind of in a dreamy state. Who are you? I don't know who you are. And this happens again and again and again. Finally, one of the helpers says, hey, look, young lady, you know, the boar queen keeps putting sleeping pills in the wine. You got to make sure he doesn't drink that. So one day she prevents Valamon from drinking the sleeping pills. And he goes, oh my God, you're just in time, because you were about to lose me. I mean, lose your soul. Yeah. If Valamon marries the boar queen, that's the mother complex. That means she has the mother complex. She never knows herself. She'll lose herself, right? So she dialogues with Valamon, and they realize, oh my God, we gotta escape. So they escaped the place, but the boar queen was enraged. That's the theories, right? In the Orestes, and then they managed to escape, and the boar queen disappeared as they escaped. So that's the end of the mother complex. So that was resolved, right? So we get a glimpse of ourselves, right? Then that helps, right? I don't fully understand. It's been a long time since I heard that story, so I'm a little hesitant about it. But Robert Bly said that if you don't find your soul, then you're gonna go back. So letting go of the bear's fur means returning to the normal, boring, limited state. So he's talking about the Roy Lichtenstein's painting. So you saw that in the painting called Stepping Out by Roy Lichtenstein. That guy there in that painting, he didn't do it. He was like the older daughter or the middle daughter. He couldn't accept the bear. So he was this bland guy. The bland-looking guy, and the vibrancy was separate from him. So the vibrancy in that painting, Stepping Out, all that vibrancy is another way of talking about the white bear, you know, or the woolly mammoth, just this powerful aliveness of affect. When we read a myth or a fairy tale psychologically, we often find ourselves astonished at the leaps of inclusiveness asked of us. So we got the leaps of inclusiveness asked of us. So when the idea that we're going to be reunited with our feelings, like, whoa, that's a leap of inclusiveness. I mean, I got to accept these disowned feelings. I've been disconnected from my feelings all my life. Now I got to include them. Whoa, that's quite a leap. What, the mother was so rejecting, and that's a symbol for my own rage? That's a leap to include the fact that I was so enraged. And I projected it onto the mother, and now I believe that the mother is shaming me, but that's really just a symbol for me, my shame projected outward. I got to include the fact that I was so enraged at being shamed. You see, leaps of inclusiveness. Those scripts mean being dysfunctional to protect the mother. I got to accept that. I got to include that in my understanding, that I gave myself up for the attachment. Whoa, that's a lot of leaps of inclusiveness. So in the second journey of midlife, we have a lot of leaps of inclusiveness to make about ourselves. And there's a lot of resistance to it. That's the wine. The guy fell asleep. The sleeping pills and the wine. That's the amnesia thing. We resist it. Okay, so we'll see if we can update that one there about Robert Bly and Merriam Woodman's description of the white bear Valamon. I hope I still managed to pique anyone's curiosity about the story. It's described in the book, in one of their books. Is the Maiden King, is that the one? You know, come to think of it, I don't think they've put it in print form as a book. It's just told individually, separately. In their common book, they talk about Valisa, what's her name? Valisa, is that the one? The Tudor one. Anyways, there's a similar story in the book Maiden King, the Maiden Tsar. The book is called Maiden King. Maybe they mention it in there as well. Yeah. But that Valamont's a good story. Yeah. There's even a movie about it. Okay, let's wind this down here. Yeah, I regret all that coffee. I think it affected my delivery today. Maybe I had a counterphobia with the caffeine. I was afraid to drink this strong coffee. If I'm afraid, then I gulped it all. I'll drink it quickly. Maybe I'll deal with that fear around drinking too much caffeine. You see, so that's an example of counterphobia. I was afraid to drink too much caffeine. So to avoid that fear, I had this counterphobic reaction where I would drink it quickly, then I would get away from that fear. But it's very detrimental to do that, because I noticed myself speaking very, very poorly in this video here. Luckily, the quotes are posted below, but I would like my delivery to be helpful as well. Because if I'm speaking in a flawed way, it's very distracting, and I don't want that to happen. So what shall we play today? Santers? Mistreating her? One of our musical voices? Rick Santers! Are you hearing it okay? It seems kind of low for some reason. Yeah, it's full volume. Yeah, let me see if I can fix the volume here. Hold on. Well, that's it, eh? See, he's talking, you're treating me badly, you're a mistreating heart. You have a mistreating heart. No! He has intrapsychic experience. The pain he's feeling is from the memory that he forgot as a baby. It's being triggered up. Yes, it's disappointing if the girl, if there's unrequited love. It's very disappointing. But this labeling, you got a mistreating heart. You got a bad heart or something. He's talking about the mother. You see, it's encoded. A lot of the anger we have at the partner really should be meant to the parent. This pain he's feeling and this blaming about the other. It's a reliving of the early time. That's sort of the anger there, right? That part there. She's just reenacting her childhood with the guy. And he's reenacting his childhood with the woman. They're both saying to each other, I love you, you're perfect, now change. Now, if she doesn't change to meet his unmet needs from nursery time, he's going to blame her. No, blame the parent. The parent had the mistreating heart. Now, why does the parent have a mistreating heart? Why did the parent mistreat the child, abuse the child? Why? Because maybe it happened to her. Maybe it happened to her. And it wasn't her fault that it happened to her. Now, she's in this compulsion to replay and reenact what happened to her in the present. So we got to understand a lot of this repetition compulsion business in order to forgive the parents. The goal is to forgive the parents. The parents didn't know it all. The parents couldn't do it all. But they did the best they could. Rick Santos' most recent song is called Lovesick, and we've played it a few times. A lot of the songs are about this, that about the infantile transference. So romantic love is the infantile transference. I love you, you're perfect, now change. But they're going to be disappointed. That's why they chose that person. Because they want to reenact what happened, to be loyal to what happened, and to be aware of what happened. So I love you, you're perfect. Now the change part is the fantasy that in the present, they wish ideally the person in the present can invent some kind of time machine, take the two back in the nursery and change the past. That's not going to happen. So what's going to happen is he's going to coax the other to disappoint them because the mother disappointed them. I love you, you're perfect, now change. It's not going to work. So they're reenacting, replaying the trauma with the mother. So if you stop blaming the girl or the guy in the present. You chose them to play the role of the disappointing parent, and you're going to expect them to be disappointed by having too much expectations, because the baby had a lot of expectations. It's unrealistic to have these kinds of expectations on anybody in the present. Nobody in the present can be the breast mother. And the person isn't an infant, obviously, right? Do you want to play another Rick Santos song? Do we have Lovesick here? Why don't we play Lovesick here if we can find it? No? Okay. Let's see what other. Let's play one or two more songs here. Yeah, this is the most caffeine I've. Okay, enough of the caffeine. Okay, hold on a sec. Jose Feliciano. We talked about him recently, Jose Feliciano. Oh yeah, we've never played this song here. This is a cover song that he does of the Doors. play some more Santos. Hold on. Let's play some. Okay, Rick Santos.
Got some people here tonight. You guys want to make some noise out there?
Song called Dreaming. Yeah,
yeah. You're in the mood for some, okay.
Let's play some Rick Santos.
I'm going to take you back. I don't know, some of you might not have been born this time, at the time this tune came out, but you might have heard it since. See if you recognize this one.
Rick Santos. The song is called Stepping Stone. What? He's saying he doesn't want to be used by the girl, right? Let's play his Don Juan song. Rick Santos has a song about the Don Juan guy. It's called The Rapper. Do we have it here? Hold on a sec. Oops. Let's play the Rick Santos' song about the Don Juan guy. I think it's this one here. Well, that's Dreaming. No, we don't have it here. Here's the other. This is the Dreaming song. Yeah. Not a bad song called Dreaming. Yeah.
Yeah, I think we do. From an album called Guitar Alley. Dreaming.
Yeah, Dream. Yeah, it's not a bad song. Why don't we close with some Street Heart here? Well, we'll just leave it here. Why don't we just leave it then? This song might be about pathological nostalgia. I'm not sure. He's only happy when he's thinking about the past, dreaming about his younger days. So he didn't mourn the loss. So yeah, maybe this song is about complicated grief. But that's the only time he's happy, dreaming about his youth. Yeah, that's complicated grief, I think.
Stranger riser under gray reflecting sky.
So a book recommendation is The Search for the Real Self by James Masterson. James F. Masterson, The Search for the Real Self. That's a great book. It'll talk about the capacities of the real self. It summarizes developmental object relations theory. He introduces his model about relational units to templates, the splitting that's going on, reenacting the past and the present. He discusses how some artists used their artistic ability to face their past. So, you know, this is part of the mourning process to consider who we used to be and the loss. Yeah, the loss of our dreams. That's a loss. Huh? I wonder who I'll become. So there's this uncertainty of the midlife phase in the mourning process. So he's describing sort of a midway of the grief process. Again, the grief process, first you're in denial. And then you're in this confused state. So this song describes sort of